Today's workshop is on me examining proposals for major changes in the ways that drugs are priced and drug development is financed. This involves the delinkage of R&D costs, research and development costs from drug prices.
Really an honor and a pleasure to be here. MSF is a medical humanitarian organization providing impartial medical care in more than 60 countries around the world to people affected by wars, natural disasters, disease outbreaks, and economic explosion. I work for the Access Campaign. The Access Campaign is one of the policy and advocacy arms of Dr. Kilbirde. It was created by Dr. Kilbirde in 1999 to deal with two main challenges of our medical operations. One is the lack of affordability of essential medical tools that we need to perform our medical operations, and second is the lack of patient-driven innovation for the same medical tools that we need to perform our medical operations. MSF, Dr. Kilbirde, is also a purchaser of medical technologies, as well as a funder of research and development through our clinical trials, the work we do in clinical trials in the field, as well as our direct funding to drugs for infectious disease initiatives. So we, for many years, have been looking at the need to reform the current innovation system so it better delivers for patients both in innovation as well as in access. We're very happy and very honored to be here to talk about the linkage. For us, the linkage is a key principle to fix the current broken innovation system so it better aligns to patients' needs. The current system is basically fundamentally broken. There's many indications of that broken system, but maybe the most powerful indication is the faces of millions of patients who currently are dying because they do not have access to medicines that they need, or the medicines they need don't even exist. What is broken? The source of the problem is how we currently finance, incentivize, and reward biomedical innovation. The expectation of revenues with high prices and sales without competition, given by patents and other intellectual property monopolies, is currently the main driver and funding mechanism for innovation. The outcomes are clear to many of you. There is a failing, the current system fails to deliver affordable products. There is a global crisis of rising drug prices across diseases, across countries, and across technologies. This is bankrupting households as well as health systems, and basically causing unnecessary death and suffering. This is immoral, basically the main outcome is rationing of essential medical care. The epidemic of high drug prices, as I said, affects everybody, not only doctors and reporters, but millions of patients also here in the United States. I want to give you two examples that are very significant for our medical operations in terms of lack of affordability of medical technologies. The first one is vaccines. MSF, like governments and health professionals, are having a huge challenge to get access to affordable vaccines. Over the last 14 years, this is becoming a huge medical priority for us, the need to lower the prices of new vaccines. Just in the poorest countries in the world, highly subsidized by donors and other mechanisms, the price to fully vaccinate a child has increased by 68-fold in the last 10 years. One of the main causes of that price increase is one vaccine, the pneumonia vaccine, that is taking up to 45% of the cost to vaccinate a fully vaccinated child in a developing country. The cost is basically monopoly. Two companies own the monopoly to manufacture and distribute the vaccine and are charging affordable prices for many countries around the world. Pneumonia vaccine is also a key intervention not only to save lives, as pneumonia is one of the biggest killers of children under 5 in developing countries, but it's also a key tool to prevent infection and avoid unnecessary use of antibiotics. No matter that, many around the world and in developing countries currently do not have access to pneumonia vaccine. The second example I want to share with you is hepatitis C. Everybody here, I'm sure, is pretty familiar with the record high prices of hepatitis C treatments here in the United States. High prices of hepatitis C treatments are also huge problems for the countries where MSF works and for MSF medical operations. This is really affecting our capacity to respond to the hepatitis C epidemic. Everybody knows about these high prices. They're in the media, they're in the news, they're in congressional hearings here in the United States. What maybe not a lot of people know is that it costs less than $100 to manufacture these pills. These prices are completely inflated given a monopoly system that does not allow competition in the manufacturing and distribution of this cure to hepatitis C. WHO just published a report a few weeks ago that shows how these high prices are basically rationing medical care around the world. Of the estimated 160 million people that currently we believe need access to hepatitis C treatments around the world, less than 1 million today have had access to these hepatitis C treatments in developing countries. That's, again, immoral, and it's completely unnecessary because these products can be produced at much more affordable cost. Well, if you look at the details of the WHO report, it's important to see which countries are really treating hepatitis C of these 1 million. Most of the patients on treatment currently come from, in fact, one country, Egypt. And the reason why is because the Egyptian government has challenged giving monopoly, has promoted generic competition, and has not only achieved a very important price discount, but is also allowed for generic competition in the cell distribution of hepatitis C. And they're leading on the scale up of this essential intervention. The second big failure, apart from lack of affordability of mental tools, is the lack of prioritization of essential health needs. MSF is witnessing firsthand the emergency of antibiotic resistance in our project, including in children in nutrition centers in Niger, adult trauma patients in Syria and Jordan. Everywhere we look, we find antibiotic resistance. In some countries, we are currently being forced to use the last line of drugs available. There is basically no other choice medically to treat these patients. And this is very scary for our medical doctors, for our medical organization, especially if you look at the pipeline and you understand that in the last 30 years there's been no innovation in the antibiotics. The industry has systematically exited research and development efforts on antibiotics while the resistance rates are increasing. We need a system that promotes innovation for all public health needs, not only antibiotic resistance, but also tuberculosis. My colleague Katie will explain the challenges that MSF is facing in treatment of multi-resistant tuberculosis and why we need the linkage also for tuberculosis. The third main challenge is that the system basically is promoting a wasteful and inefficient ways of using scientific and financial resources. There are many consequences of a system based on monopolies and high prices to reward innovation. Many of them are unsatisfactory. It's costly, it's wasteful. There is no transparency in research and development costs and expenditures, but pharmaceutical company claims it costs at a minimum $10 to $100 million to develop a new compound. What we know for sure is that there is duplication of unnecessary clinical trials, there is duplication of studies and promotion of studies with little or added therapeutic value, and promotion of me-too products and innovations that do not really represent scientific breakthroughs. We also know there are barriers follow on innovation. There are also public health significance, including pediatrics, fixed dose combinations, and any formulations that should be developed. We are concerned also on the lack of collaboration and the redundancy of scientific efforts. The current system promotes competition among researchers, secrecy, and, as I said, lack of collaboration, and that should be a concern for the scientific community and anybody who's concerned with an innovation system of healthy nature. This is wrong. All of this is wrong, this is unacceptable, and this all can be changed. This is not a market failure, this is a public policy failure. This is a consequence of a choice that the US government and other governments have made. The Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement, the TPP, is the latest manifestation of that choice, and it failed, among other reasons, because many countries around the world rejected global monopolies for pharmaceutical products, as the US was proposing in the Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement. These problems are all interconnected and can be tied to the organization and financing of the research and development system. So what is the linkage? The linkage is the cure. The cure to the policy and government failure that is causing unnecessary death and suffering to millions around the world and in the United States is the key reform that we currently pay, the way we currently pay for biomedical innovation and the way we currently incentivize that biomedical innovation. The idea is simple. We are going to propose, and it's been implemented, to separate the way we pay for research and development from the expectation of monopolies that result in high prices and high sales as the only form of revenue. Under the Delinkage model, research and development should be fully paid off and rewarded. Profits should be made, but products can be competitively produced and marketed in a rational and public health-driven manner. The expectation of high prices becomes irrelevant. And therapeutic outcomes and appropriate volumes of cells are norms that define how innovation will be rewarded. The outcomes, products that are not overpriced or overconsumed, because markets for innovation and markets for production and sales are separate. What is not the linkage is any funding mechanism that relies upon high prices and monopolies to incentivize innovation. The key, of course, is how we can pay for innovation under the linkage model. To answer that question, it's important to remember how much are we paying for research and development and who is paying for research and development program. We, as taxpayers and as consumers, are already paying for research and development, and many times without paying with very poor outcomes, as I tried to explain. The linkage can be implemented in many different ways. Funding options can be direct funding, NIH grants, contracts, BARDA funding, as currently exists and should be expanded, as well as subsidies, tax credits, as well as pool incentives, including prizes and cash awards, or a combination of all of them. The linkage is a norm. Its implementation can be flexible and adapted to the specific medical needs of one technology or specific interest of a given government that implements the linkage or funder. The linkage has already shown successful outcomes. Drugs for Negative Diseases Initiative that MSF funds and support, as well as many other public-private partnerships that mostly work in the field of negative diseases, have already bring new products into the market for neglected diseases under the linkage model. The PATH WHO project for meningitis A vaccine already implements the linkage and has been a vaccine that is affordable, adapted to all patients' needs, and we're using in our medical operations. MSF, Doctors Without Borders, is strongly advocating for the linkage to be extended to other medical priorities. As Katie will present, we have a specific project for tuberculosis, but we would like to see the linkage extend also to other medical priorities. Finally, I just want to find my words. The linkage has been internationally endorsed broadly at the WHO, at the UN High Level Meeting on Antibiotic Resistance and the political declaration recently adopted, as well as the most recently at the UN Secretary General High Level Panel on Access to Medicines. Even some pharmaceutical companies are understanding that the linkage is not a negative norm, it's not an anti-profit norm, it's not an anti-pharma norm. It's a norm to allow everybody to win. Many pharmaceutical companies have endorsed the linkage for antibiotic resistance and are supporting the applicability of the linkage as a tool for stewardship in exchange for public funding for antibiotic resistance. What MSF would like to see is full the linkage also for antibiotic resistance, and not only to ensure stewardship, but also to ensure affordability. And a public return, a full public return on this public investment that governments are making on antibiotics. The US government, unfortunately, the biggest funder of research and development in the world, and one of the biggest payers of high prices in the world, is the only government that has yet to fully endorse the linkage and test its applicability to its full potential. Unfortunately, millions of US taxpayer money goes to NIH, BARDA, and other incentives, including the $300 million currently valued for the FDA Priority Review Voucher for neglected tropical diseases, without any conditions attached to this public funding, any public return in this public investment that ensures that products are going to be made affordable and available to patients, as well as appropriate to consume and market. Thank you very much for the opportunity to be here today. I very much appreciate the invitation from Knowledge Ecology International, and looking forward to this discussion.
Thank you so much.
There's three ways to be a patient right now. You either have insurance and you don't really know how much the drug costs and you go and you get your medicine, or you have a big copay and you just hope the copay is not going to get higher and higher, or you just don't get any treatment, right? There's the three scenarios. So not to talk too long about myself, I'm one of the lucky ones. I'm a cancer patient in active treatment since 2010. And I know it's a bit disturbing to talk about personal stuff, but some patients have to talk about personal stuff. It's a long life now with cancer for most people, for the lucky ones, right? And we know it costs a lot of money. The drug intake I took for 4 years now, on another one, Herceptin, made $60 billion for Roche. So it's big money, right? And I'm hoping that I would help Kinsella make even more money for longer. But basically, we worry about costs, we worry about access, and we worry about innovation. I say innovation,
yes, here,
because innovation is the next drug for me. what's it in the pipeline? I don't know. There's a lot of research, but not that as much as people in stage 4 cancer hope for. So today, whatever people say, we think there's a link. And when I say we, I'm talking for from a patient point of view. We are told that there's a link between R&D and the new drugs we're going to get if we get a new drug. We are told that if they don't cost a lot of money, there will be no more drugs for us. In a way, I like to think about patients as hostage to a negotiation that they're not part of. It's a very ineffective system, but we can't have an impact in it. Why? Probably because there's a bit of a Stockholm syndrome, if you see what I mean. A lot of the patients and patients group are kind of nervous to rock the system. I am too, sometimes. And we'll also know that R&D is expensive. We are not like fools. We don't think it's free, that it comes from the gods. We know it takes a lot of scientists, a lot of time, a lot of effort, a lot of investment, a lot of risk to create the next drug that I'm gonna need. But we also know, most of us, that the high cost of medicine is caused by monopolies, which results in rationing. Because that's what patients think about. That's why they're scared. We're always scared that there's gonna be rationing. Is this really for the greater good? Because that's what we're told. I don't know how many people here saw the movie Hot Fuzz, but when you see it as a patient, you think about it differently. We always put, you know, in front of the, it's for the greater good. And I talked recently with a patient who has the same disease I have in Wales. And she is not taking the drug anymore. They decided to stop it. First time her enzyme or blood test came up a little high, they decided, no, it's not gonna work. Anyway, it was already incredible that she was getting it because TDM1, Katsila, is not available in Wales. But one thing she said to me was, well, you know, it's a national system, maybe it's for the greater good. It really shocked me that a woman in her 30s, much younger than me, with little kids, would accept the idea it's for the greater good, that she might die in a couple of years of a terrible death, which is not necessary. So that's it for the disturbing cancer patient side of it. But you have to remember that rationing is not rational at all. There must be a better way. We have to find a way to finance better R&D, more R&D, without threatening access to life-saving drugs. We're not talking about mouse traps here. We're talking about life or death. It is possible, and it is necessary. It is necessary for the US government, among all the governments, to start looking at the price it's gonna cost to all of us. Every time my drug is paid, your premium goes up, you know? And since I've been a cancer patient, the price of the drugs I'm taking is getting higher and higher. I'm one of those few patients that open the letters to see how much it costs. Today I'm gonna go for treatment after this meeting at 2 o'clock. And Monday I'll get the bill, but thank God I don't pay. So far it's mumbo jumbo, insurance, donation, cancer center, discount. It's $9,000 this afternoon for one drug. It used to be less. So, you know, if I'm lucky and I live longer, it might be like $20,000 every 3 weeks. And that's one drug, remember that. So, Delinkage, for me, it's a big idea, but it's a simple idea. It's the only good idea right now. I'm waiting to hear better ideas. What are the goals? The goals is to pay for innovative medicines, important for patients, and all of you can end up being patients or have people you love as patients. And it's also to ensure more access to all patients. And I'm really grateful for Judit and for our work for all patients. But it's not just about cancer and cancer in the US. It's more than that. It's the whole world is in big trouble here. So Delinkage, and you're going to hear a lot of experts who are going to give you a lot of numbers and ways to do it. But in simple terms to me, it's the models that I've seen are basically not dependent on high pricing of important medicine. I'm not talking about the non-important medicine, the me-too drugs, the drugs that don't have a big effect on diseases. I'm talking about real good medicine. And there's always this objection I talked to you about, the negative impact on R&D, and that's one of the reasons Delinkage is the big idea, the simple idea, the best one, is that it's a combination of different ways. There's research grants, no way we're going to get rid of that. There's prizes, there's probably a lot of private and public partnership. I mean, it's we have to be realistic. It's not only government that have to pay. The drug that kept me alive for 4 years was Herceptin. The scientist, it's an interesting story, the scientist needed money that was raised by Revlon, a whole corporation. But anyway, that saved my life for 4 years, so I'm not gonna poo-poo Revlon anymore. So with full implementation of Delinkage, we could have basically generic competition, low prices for product. And we could imagine also other funding. There's money out there. We need money for R&D, and there's money. Believe me, there's money. We found money when we need it. It's just a question of putting that money into R&D. So, I think there's going to be several panels explaining to you the different kind of models, and I won't go into details, but we all know that more competition will result in better prices. Better prices for all of us, not just for cancer patients, for people who pay premium, for employers, for governments. Think about Medicare, all these older people like me, you know, who are going to need treatment for more than 2 years. Right? And the young people, like my children, they get into the workforce much later than they used to. I don't think most of my kids have not contributed much, and they're close to 30 now. It's sad. So conclusion, we all understand here that we have to pay for innovation. Even the patients understand that. Don't patronize patients. They know we have to pay. But they also know that it doesn't have to be through high prices. That's not true. It doesn't have to go through monopolies. And we saw the rejection of the TPP by people, by patients, as a sure sign that they're starting to be aware that monopolies is not helping them at all, even in the US. So UACT, the Union for Affordable Cancer Treatment, which is a new group, whose governance is a little blocked by some members that I won't name. But it's a new group that's being set up right now, and we support Delinkage. And it's important that more patient group and most people associated with patients start looking at different models of funding better and more R&D for our health needs of all of us. Thank you. Thank you both so much, and looking forward to hearing the rest of the discussion.
Our next panel is going to dive a little bit deeper into Delinkage and talk about direct funding and product prices. We have a very deep panel here today. So on my left, who will go first, is Aidan Hollis. He's a professor at the Department of Economics at University of Calgary. To the left, he's also the president of the Incentives for Global Health, which is thinking about or trying to pilot a project that would use Delinkage to get drugs to more people. And then Sitting next to him is Joe Larsen. He's the acting director of BARDA, the Biomedical Advanced Research Development Authority, which is a part of HHS. They do a lot of work on antibiotic resistance and helping incentivize new treatments for medical countermeasures. Next to him is Dean Baker, the co-director of the Center for Economic Policy and Research. And then after that, we have Jamie Love, who you met before. And then we'll have two respondents, Patrick Kilbirde, sorry if I mispronounced that. He's the executive director of intellectual property at the US Chamber of Commerce. And then James McGee from the Transit Employees Health and Welfare Fund of the Metro. So let me get started.
I'm supposed to talk about delinkage for antibiotics. Antibiotics are special for a variety of reasons. One thing is that there is a crisis in antibiotics. The O'Neill Commission has estimated that by 2050, something like 10 million lives a year and a cumulative $100 trillion of economic output are at risk due to the rise of drug-resistant infections if we don't find some solutions. So this is important, and there are enough dollars at stake to get everyone's attention. We've also seen the rise of resistant bacteria in a number of areas. It's particularly severe in tuberculosis, where there are now so-called totally drug-resistant infections, and certainly a rise almost everywhere in extensively drug-resistant infections. We also see more and more resistance to bacteria for ordinary kinds of infections. So pretty much everyone recognizes that the business model needs fixing. The key issues are that commercial success requires relatively high volume, but preserving the effectiveness of the drug requires low utilization. Too much utilization, we end up with degrading the effectiveness of the drug as resistance develops. Everyone has recognized this, as I say, and that includes the pharmaceutical companies, governments, the Davos Declaration earlier this year of pharmaceutical companies explicitly said that delinkage of some sort was needed in this area. So this is something that even the companies are on side with for antibiotics. And so that provides, I think, an opportunity for moving ahead in delinkage, maybe in a trial way in antibiotics. It's certainly worth thinking about this as something that deserves attention from civil society, from governments, from industry, because of the need to make progress here. There are a number of other special characteristics of antibiotics. Many countries have very poor quality usage of antibiotics, which leads to increased resistance. That needs to be addressed. There are externalities across borders when people misuse antibiotics or even just use them. In one country, there's a risk of resistance developing, which spreads. And there are also externalities across products. So sometimes if there's a similar mechanism of action, you also have the spread of resistance across drugs. This makes this space complicated and also ripe for trying to use an alternative mechanism, one that is not so reliant on simple prices. So before I sort of address antibiotics and delinkage really specifically, I think it's useful to just present a little framework for thinking about innovation with the delinkage. And the key issue that I want to address is, how do you decide who pays for the innovation and on what basis? So there are essentially two ways that you can have delinkage. You can have delinkage where the government just directly funds the innovation, just funds the R&D itself, and then and then, for example, as generic competition. A second approach is to have the private sector innovating, and then to have competition after that. And the question is, if you're going to have private sector innovation, on what basis are the rewards to be paid? Should they be paid on the basis of the cost of doing the innovation, or, for example, the average cost of innovation? Should you have some kind of a tax credit system, in which case you're still basing the essentially the government subsidy to the firm on the cost that the firm has incurred? The second approach is to have the rewards based on value, the social value in some sense of the innovation. So that's the approach that has been proposed in Senator Sanders' bills. The Health Impact Fund is an approach that looks like this. A third approach is to think about having rewards which are based on the hypothetical profitability of the innovation if there had not been a delinkage system. I'm just going to point out that this last approach really doesn't solve any of the relevant problems, so I'm going to ignore it. So one approach, I want to start with rewards based on cost. If you have rewards based on cost, there is a risk that such rewards would encourage products that are just adequate for approval, and they certainly don't reward products that are really fantastic in a significant way. The challenge is that rewards, so products that are just adequate for approval are certainly the ones that are easiest to develop and probably also the least useful. So it makes sense that there should be some kind of relationship of the reward to value. And here it's also true that tax credits can help, but you still need to have some residual reward based on value in order to direct innovation towards the things that are most valued. So there are really two kinds of approaches to thinking about how you should reward based on value. So one approach that's been proposed by John Rex and Kevin Anderson is that payment should be based on the technical characteristics of the product, and that those technical characteristics should be defined in advance with basically a schedule of what's going to be paid for. And they propose that you should have specifically higher payments for products that address important needs, have a new mechanism of action, treat multiple pathogens, feature oral dosing. In many ways, it's kind of similar to the advanced markets pneumococcal vaccine, which faced a similar problem in that, in general, it's quite hard to specify the technical characteristics that we desire fully in advance. So then the issue is, well, what about side effects? Or how effective does the product need to be? So the O'Neill Commission, a little bit later this year, this is kind of interesting, right? The things that I'm referring to, these are being published this year. This definitely is an area where there's lots of action. So the O'Neill Commission in the UK proposed that there should be a market entry reward based on value to society. They said kind of in the range of $1 billion. The payment would depend on the same kinds of things as Rex and Anderson proposed, but it should include things like efficacy, and it should include, essentially, that means that it's going to have to be measured ex post. You'll have to wait until the product's introduced. It may take some time until you know how effective the product is, so payments would therefore be staggered over time, depending on how the product is actually being used. O'Neill proposed that the product rights remain with the developer, so this doesn't look like the normal delinkage schemes. They also proposed that the conditions for the reward would include an access scheme for low and middle income countries, but not necessarily for high income countries. So you'd end up with a two-tier market. You'd have delinkage, really, in low income countries, and in high income countries, you'd have the normal high prices with monopolies. They also observe that it's essential to improve antimicrobial stewardship in all countries, and in order to do this effectively, we're going to need to have some money. I'll just observe a couple of challenges for delinkage and antibiotics. One is that companies want rewards that are highly predictable. Something like the ones that are proposed by Rex and Harrison, in which the rewards based on measured technical innovation, and payers want rewards that motivate investment in what's most valuable. It's going to be important to balance those. In terms of pricing, it's really important to have prices that enable access. But at the same time, in antibiotics, there's a concern that there should be controls on access to prevent inappropriate use. And really, this is going to take a lot more money in terms of stewardship. And often, high prices are proposed as a mechanism to control usage in antibiotics. Not really a good idea, but we do need to invest in alternative ways of ensuring that access is controlled and that inappropriate use is limited. I guess I should just conclude by saying this is an area where there's a lot of opportunity for progress. Although I've presented challenges, and I don't think the challenges should stop us from trying to make progress here. Thank you.
Say that you're going to hear kind of a reiteration of everything you just heard, but maybe slightly differently, so that'll help those that maybe missed it the first go around. So I'm here to talk about a specific form of economic incentive to serve as a delinkage approach to antibiotics, which is called market entry reward. Historically, I'm with an organization called BARDA, which is part of the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services. We're here to partner with and incentivize biotech and pharmaceutical companies to make products for where there is market challenges related to public health emergencies. And you can go on to the next slide. Yeah, that's it. So the BARDA model is one that was born out of actually the anthrax attacks of 2001, where we had no products whatsoever to treat that infection, and there was no companies interested in developing those products because there wasn't a market. And the U.S. Congress stepped in and created a set of both push and pull incentives that allowed us to build and create a marketplace for those products that have now resulted in 25 products FDA approved in the decade that BARDA has been in existence, and 15 products stockpiled for emergency use. Similarly, there was in the H1N1 pandemic, or flu pandemic that occurred, there was a detection of a market failure in the sense that vaccine manufacturers only made enough influenza vaccine to support the seasonal market. And BARDA stepped in and with our international partners and both domestically worked with companies to build out influenza vaccine manufacturing capacity so that now we can manufacture 500 million doses of influenza vaccine within 6 months of detection of a pandemic virus. I'm just trying to give you a sense of the types of problems that we're attempting to solve. Right now we helped respond to the Ebola outbreak in West Africa. We're currently supporting an Ebola vaccine that we hope to get to licensure within the next 18 months to 24 months. And that vaccine currently has a market potential of $0. So how do we incentivize companies to want to make these products to be able to absorb the opportunity cost that goes with, directing R&D efforts into this area in a way that's going to reward the innovation but also protect our investments? When we think about protecting our investments from a public health emergency preparedness standpoint. In 2010, we saw that antibiotic resistance was a significant public health threat and one that was basically a public health emergency. And so we stepped in and began forming public-private partnerships in this area, which was largely a push incentive that basically lowered the research and development costs, subsidized R&D costs. And to date, we've now advanced 6 programs into phase 3 clinical development. Our first new drug application for a BARDA-sponsored antibiotic was submitted in April of this year. Our second should be submitted before the end of this calendar year. And we also formed a transatlantic public-private partnership dedicated to promoting innovation in antibacterial drug development called CARB-X. But I'm not going to talk anymore about that today. But if anybody has any interest about that, please let me know. Next slide. So this is the current model. If you're a company that's going to be making investments in R&D for an antibiotic, for really any other drug, but for specifically we'll talk about antibiotics. And you have to make investments in R&D that not only account for your successes, but also accounts for your failures. And the failures along the way, data from GlaxoSmithKline would suggest that you need 72 candidates in the discovery phase to get one out that's FDA approved. You need 18 entering initial human testing to get one out that's FDA approved. You need about 9 in phase 2 development, and you need about 2.5 in phase 3 development to end up with one approved molecule. And all of those things have costs on the order of several hundred millions of dollars to be able to do those studies. So then you get approved. Congratulations, your new antibiotic is approved. And if it's used appropriately, it's going to be the last thing that's given. They're going to use the generic antibiotic first because the vast majority of infections are susceptible to generic antibiotics. And so that doesn't engender a model of a high degree of commercial return. And then you have a specific period of time, and then eventually you go off patent and you're generic, and then you're basically taken out of the market. And so if you were a company that was looking, and I should say that all the risks and all the failures and along the way, and then taking into account what you're going to make into the money in the future from your commercial returns, but discounting that over time, is something called net present value, which is a term that the pharmaceutical industry uses to determine whether or not a program is going to be profitable. And we'll return to that momentarily. Next slide. So if you look at the last 6 antibiotics that were approved in the United States and you take into account their first 2 years of sales or projected sales, they basically range from $30 million to about $75 million. Okay, and that may seem like a lot of money, but if you look at drugs like Lyrica, which is for diabetic nerve pain, or Spiriva, and that's the one in the commercial with the elephant sitting on the person's chest and they can't breathe because it's for COPD, those revenues in the first 2 years were $1 billion, $750 million. And so, if I were to give you $10,000 and I say, I want you to invest in a pharmaceutical company, and where would you put your money? Would you put your money on the company that's making $1 billion in 2 years or one that's making 30? And so that's one of the things that, really where delinkage can come in and assist, and because what we really want, and when we're talking about incentives, we need to ask ourselves, what do we want those incentives to do? And, in my mind, we really want these companies to feel compelled to make their own internal investments in R&D so that we're continuing to promote innovation in this space. Next slide. And that's because the current innovation in antibacterial drug development is very low. It's not occurring at the pace we need. It's not occurring at the pace to keep up with resistance. And it's not occurring to counter technical attrition, which is normal in pharmaceutical development. So, there's a certain type of bacterial infection called gram-negative infections. And these are the superbugs that, people talk about that you usually get in a hospital. It's a really unfortunate, infection when you get one. There hasn't been a new antibiotic class brought to market for these infections in 45 years. So, just stop and think about that for a second. Think about renewable energy. Think about computers, even. What did a computer look like in the late 1960s versus what it looks like today? And you don't even have to drift away from the same technological sector. We stay in pharmaceuticals. Think about oncology. What were your treatment options for cancer in the late 1960s versus what they are today? And it's also evidenced by the pipeline. Right now, we have 37 antibiotics in phase 2 or phase 3 clinical development. For oncology, we have over 500. And so it's driven by commercial returns. And in antibiotics, there's still a very, very fragile market. We are in an era of commercialization, not innovation. What I mean is that we can sit here and point to different acquisitions. Pfizer just bought AstraZeneca's antibiotic unit. A couple years ago, Merck bought Cuba's antibiotic unit. But the model is one where we're not doing internal R&D anymore. We've bought in very late-stage molecules that we're going to take to market. Of the last 8 antibiotics that were approved in the United States, only one, Bedequilin for TB, maintained ownership from its entire life from discovery through market. On average, the antibiotics changed hand 2.89 times. So that means if it's just from discovery, somebody else buys it for this clinical development, and somebody else buys it when it gets into phase 3. And that's not necessarily a bad thing, but it's not a model that promotes innovation in this area. Next slide. Why do we need incentives for new antibiotics? Primarily, number one, it's uncertainty in the use at launch. Again, as I mentioned, when a new antibiotic comes out, it's not like a cancer drug. Antibiotics are approved in the United States based upon the basis of non-inferiority data. And that's just basically the way you have to do clinical trials for antibiotics. It basically means this drug is just as good as the last thing. Unlike cancer, when typically you can do a superiority trial, the drug is differentiated and there's in value in prescribing. When you have cancer, you get the newest cancer drug because it's the best cancer drug. For antibiotics, the newest antibiotic is usually held in reserve because we want to preserve the efficacy for as long as we can, which is appropriate, but it doesn't engender a high degree of commercial returns. Generics, as I previously mentioned, can treat the vast majority of susceptible infections, so we're going to go to those first before we go to your drug that you just developed. And in general, historically, these drugs have been lower, more prices have been lower than other drugs, and it's been the tolerance of the market to price higher has not been tolerated, and that's actually a good thing for access for patients and people who need or are experiencing a severe bacterial infection. So we need a different model to promote innovation and make sure that these companies actually are rewarded for making a new antibiotic because we need them. Next slide. So incentives, as I mentioned before, that figure net present value. It's all the risk, it's all the opportunity of money that they're going to make. Incentives need to be able to improve the net present value calculation for these products. Because if they're in their board sitting, what is my market potential for making a new antibiotic? And they make those decisions early in development, in discovery and preclinical development, 10, 15 years before that antibiotic is marketed. They need to be able to count on that, that return at the end of development. Incentives need to possess minimal disruptive effects. What do I mean by that? What does the world look like if tomorrow we change the price from the last marketed beta-lactam-beta-lactamase inhibitor combination, which is, Abicaz is the name of the drug, which right now is about $8,000. What if we made it $80,000? What is the disruptive effect of that to patients, to insurance companies, to global health? And one of the advantages of DNA, and another incentive that's been batted around is tradable patent vouchers and things like that, and creating another market where you get antibiotic approved and you can trade the patent voucher to another more profitable drug in your portfolio. And that's a very disproportionate incentive because now you're making thousands of people pay higher drug prices for incentivizing the development of a drug that only a limited population of people are actually going to need. And so, delinkage, bottom line, possesses the most minimal disruptive effects of any of the incentives that we've talked about. We want to reward innovation, we want to ensure conservation of these drugs to preserve their utility for as long as we can, and we don't want to impact patient access. Next slide. So, again, speaking to delinkage, antibiotics are the only class of drug that whose use diminishes their utility. The more we use the drugs, the less effective they become. Our current business model, right, is that the profitability of a drug is directly proportional to the volume that we sell. And the volume we sell is probably proportional to the amount we use. So we need to adopt a different market model that rewards innovation and it puts provisions in, and in this model of being directly proportional to volume, so that is contradictory to what we want to do from a public health perspective. So we need to figure out a different way to do that. And that, in my mind, is a delinkage model, and I'll talk about what we're thinking that potentially could look like on the next slide. Which is a market entry reward system that provides a series of basically milestone payments that would occur at market, not at approval. We want the drug to be introduced into the market. And then a series of payments to keep it. And that's, the other issue is why not one gigantic payment? Why not one single payment? These need to be spread out over years to keep the company at the table because it costs. There's an opportunity cost every year of producing that molecule. They still need to have the warehouse. They still need to have the distribution system, the factory. And so, but those payments really provide us from a public health perspective with an immense opportunity because we can put stipulations to those payments. Payments provide leverage. So you can say, all right, I'll give you a payment if you agree to not market your drug. I'll give you a payment if, there's five antibiotics right now that are being produced for complicated urinary tract infections. Why is that? Because it's the easiest, cheapest, and most regulatorily reliable pathway to getting your drug into the market. Is that how those drugs are going to be used? They're mostly going to be used to treat severe hospital-acquired infections like carbapenem-resistant Enterobacteriaceae, or CRE. But there's also a whole other set of indications that we could be pursuing. We could guide the development. Particularly, there's very few drugs being developed right now for hospital-acquired and ventilator-associated pneumonia. There's also very few drugs right now that are being developed as oral formulations to treat gram-negative infection. There are women right now with uncomplicated urinary tract infections that are having to get PICC lines to treat those infections. So, could you incentivize companies to develop, just as was mentioned with the priorities, can we direct them to those priorities we need these drugs developed for? You could also control. You could also think about controlling price. You could also think about controlling what enters into the marketplace by discussing what a cap on an annual production level would look like. And these are all different ways that we could think about achieving public health objectives while simultaneously rewarding innovation. And I'll stop there. Thank you.
Thanks, Joe. And next we have Dean Baker, again, who's the co-director of the Center for Economic Policy and Research.
Thanks. This is the last of my zombie conferences that were planned when we expected a different political environment. But in any case, I think there is some cause of optimism, which I hope to get to at the end of this. I'm approaching this from a little different perspective in the sense that I'm first and foremost an economist, and I sort of do this in my spare time, so I'm not a public health expert, but I want to make a generic case for delinkage, which may be kind of old hat to everyone here, maybe new to some people, but I approach it as an economist just to comment on, you know, the extent of distortions, the amount that is at stake, you know, saying it as an economic perspective, understanding we're talking about people's lives, we're talking about people's health, but this is also a huge economic issue. And I will say a bit about the alternatives, not going into as much depth as what we've heard here, but I will say, make a few comments. Okay, first off, just, you know, understanding this, so again, speaking as an economist, patents are a distortion of the market, they're protectionism. I don't know how many times I say this, economists, they look like I'm a nut, and go, no, there's a patent, go, the market doesn't care. Okay, so to take an extreme case, a body, you can get a high-quality generic for $200 in India, now, or is it lower? $60. Okay, I'm gonna make it $200. And the list price here is $84,000. Okay, so what's that? There's a tariff of 40,000%. Okay, and it works the same way as a tariff of 40,000%. I'll go through some of the distortion. But again, the market doesn't care if you call it a patent. It's the same story. It's a distortion. Now, the second point I'll just make is that it's huge in terms of the size of the economy. We spent about $430 billion a year, I'm just talking about the United States, I mean, worldwide, we about three times that. We spend about $430 billion a year on prescription drugs. If we snapped our fingers and got rid of all patent-related protection, we'd be talking about spending 10 or 20% of that amount. Okay, so the difference is somewhere in the order of $350 billion a year. Okay, it's a bit shy of 2% GDP. You have huge, huge fights in here over 1% of that amount. Okay, so this is an enormous amount of money at stake. And I'm just talking about the United States. I'm not talking about the rest of the world, which obviously we care about. I'm just trying to focus on the issue here. Now, what are the distortions? Again, this is even the United States. Well, most obvious one is you have a lot of people that can't afford drugs they need. Yeah, it's a pretty bad story. If they're available to generic price, imagine somebody's $200. You know, I understand for a really poor person it's a problem, but most people would be able to afford it, and we easily enough get the $200 for those who can't, if there were a political commitment to that. That wouldn't be a big deal. Another part of it is people often don't use drugs in a prescribed dosage. So there's any number of accounts, there's a lot of research on this, so it's not just anecdotal. You have a lot of people, their drugs are expensive, so they only take them every other day, or they cut them in half. They do things like that, and they're not getting properly treated. Sometimes that's very, very harmful. Again, if they were cheap, that would be a non-issue. The third point, drug companies lie. I was going to use a more graceful term, but this is the era of Donald Trump. They lie, you know, and this is, again, you know, as an economist, what do we think people do when they have a lot of incentive not to tell the truth? In a context where you have a company with a monopoly on breakthrough, important breakthrough drug, we want competition. Two, three, four drugs, that will reduce the price. On the other hand, when you have a drug that's a pretty effective treatment for the condition it's intended to treat without, you know, harmful side effects in most cases, again, I'm not an expert on the outcomes, but as I understand, they're pretty damn good, you won't spend a lot of money developing the second, third, and fourth. You know, again, it's always better to have more drugs, but we're probably better off devoting those research dollars to a disease, a condition where there is no treatment, rather than the second, third, fourth, you know, survival. And the last point is secrecy slows research. And again, I said this to economists, you know, we have norms in economics. Everything is supposed to be open. You know, if I publish a paper and someone goes, oh, where's your data? And I go, oh, I can't share that with you. Well, that's not supposed to happen. You know, you call Pfizer and ask for their test results. You will not get them. You know, I had trouble. I once talked to a researcher funded by the NIH, I thought it was from Mars, asking for NIH funded research. You know, that slows research. Okay, so these are all issues of, you know, patent support that I think are, you know, hugely wasteful and, you know, associated with this massive overspending for prescription drugs. Now, just saying a little bit, again, you know, people have gone into much, much more detail than I'm about to on the alternatives, but I just want to say a couple of points. First off, you know, we have these various patent buyout schemes. I'll acknowledge, and I've had some back and forth with Jamie, who I know a big advocate is. I'm more of a skeptic in that. I'll just say two reasons. One, already hit that by Aidan. I think that whatever you do is going to be very problematic in terms of awarding prizes. You know, in other words, I just don't think there's a perfect way to do it. There's better ways, but I think that's going to be very problematic, and I think that will be a very big issue. And just to give one sort of basic point, that it's going to be very hard where you have competitors, you know, trying to, you know, work for a common, trying to get a common, cure the same disease, same condition. You may have a situation where someone has a very important breakthrough and they don't get the credit for it because the competitor comes through and gets the final prize. And I know there's ways to try and work around that, but I just think that's very, very hard to deal with. But the bigger problem, or you can decide which is the bigger, that my main problem is that you do preserve the incentive for secrecy. So the whole point, if you have patent prizes, or however we call them, if we have prizes for people are being paid based on, you know, their outcome after the fact, you have an incentive the whole time to keep everything secret. And even at the point where it's bought out, you know, in principle we can say, okay, we bought you out, you have to disclose everything, you still have the issue that you're gonna try to conceal as much as you can. So I'm getting awarded the prize, you know, it's $5 billion, whatever it might be, it's a great breakthrough, and I'll just try to give them, oh, here's what I did. You won't give them all the information over here. So you're not gonna give them any more than you absolutely have to. That would be your incentive. Now, we want them to give you everything, but will they do that? Their incentive is not to. So direct funding would be, you know, my preferred option. I could go through different routes, but I'll just say a couple things about that. One point about direct funding is that everything could be open from day one, and that could be a requirement, that you're doing funding, think of NIH times two times three, you're putting money on the table, the condition of getting the money, and you're walking contract out, so you get subcontractors, but the condition is anyone that touches that money, everything they do is in the public domain from day one. So that means both the research findings, so you've done some interesting research findings, you put them up on the web as soon as practical, any other researcher could see that. So they could benefit from those findings, they don't go down the same wrong path, or they see that you've gotten the right path and they follow up and try and, you know, work from that. So you have incentives for openness rather than secrecy. The other point is that, you know, from the other angle of that secrecy is that, you know, the clinical trials themselves, you know, this, I'll come back in a second, clinical trials themselves, we should know much, much more about the clinical trials simply for good health outcomes. So, you know, we have drug A for treating hepatitis C or whatever condition it might be. Well, is drug A as effective for men as for women? Is it as effective for older people as for young people? Is it as effective for people who also suffer from arthritis or are taking arthritis drug? That information is only available to us now insofar as the industry chooses to make it available. If you had all of this open, then that would be a non-issue. Okay, well that brings me to my second point in that is that we have sort of natural break, you know, so if I'm gonna say, okay, we're gonna replace everything the drug industry does tomorrow, obviously that's silly. But we do have a natural break in the sense of clinical trials, so we can separate out the clinical trial process from the basic research process. And to my view, there's a lot more to be gained to have direct funding of clinical trials than the basic research, since that is where the biggest problems with falsification goes. So in other words, if you have someone that's lying about their basic research, you know, preclinical stuff, well, that's unfortunate, you don't want to see it, but that's never going to get to a patient. Because someone in the clinical trial process, people will find out, hopefully won't get the point where it actually hurts anymore, but that will be found out. So if you have someone who's lying about their results in preclinical phase, that's not going to lead to a marketed product. Okay, so that's where we should worry more about it. And the clinical trials, obviously this radically reduces the time involved, that if you could fund some number of clinical trials, we're talking about much, much shorter period, still often a very long period, but much, much shorter period till we can get drugs on the market at generic prices. Now, I'll finish quickly with my one cause for optimism. I was thinking about this and thinking, well, actually, James got a very good point. If we think about, you know, what could you do in a context, and maybe the Trump administration will surprise us, so I don't know, you know, he's actually said critical things in the pharmaceutical industry, so, you know, who knows, we'll see. But in any case, suppose for the moment that, you know, the idea of getting any substantial amount of federal funding for direct research is not going to be on the agenda, direct clinical trial. It's not inconceivable that you could envision some amount of money being put up for a prize for buying up an existing patent, the rights to the drug, and putting it in the public domain and allowing it to be sold as generic. So can you envision a philanthropy doing it, a large state government, maybe some coalition of governments, state, other countries? It doesn't seem impossible. It just seems to me it's incredibly important to sort of get this in the public's mind that we don't have to pay $84,000 for a breakthrough drug. It's not expensive, it's almost invariably cheap. And if you could just get that example out there with one, two, three drugs that would be visible to people, and again, I'm thinking very much US-centric, I'm sorry about that, but I think that's where the action of this has to be. So if you can get that in the minds of people on some number of, you know, again, it doesn't have to be a breakthrough like Sobaty, but some drugs that have a real impact, I think that can make a very, very big difference. And just to sum up, you know, I've used this analogy, maybe people have heard it before, but it just strikes me as incredibly absurd how we've sort of accepted this method of paying for drugs. And the analogy I make is, it's as though we paid firefighters at the point where they showed up to the fire with your house burning and your family inside, and they go, how much do you want to pay? And to make it even worse, imagine you had a company, an insurer, that would cover some amount, and you have to call them up and say, hey, how much are you willing to cover this? That's what we've done with prescription drugs. It is a really, really bad way to finance the research.
Sometimes in policy wonk world, people refer to ways of financing as being either push or pull. Not super intuitive, but the idea is that a push fund would be something like a grant that you get from the NIH or the BARDA or the Army or something like that. And then a pull incentive would be something where you put your own money, your own skin in the game into an investment, and that you get some, you know, it would have to be an incentive to make you want to do that. And the basic pull incentive idea is the idea is if you don't achieve some result you're shooting for, which is uncertain, you don't get anything. So it's a risk-taking type of a concept. Now the current risk-taking incentive we have is a grant of a temporary monopoly. So you invest maybe $100 million, $200 million in clinical trials, whatever the number might be. And then if the product fails, you get nothing. If the product succeeds, then you just rack up as much as you can under this a fireman coming to the burning house scenario that Dean quite accurately described. we know that the monopolists charge high prices. We know that access is limited and unfair in those situations. Next slide. I'm not going to go on forever about this, but I'm just going to try and get to the model of things. So Senator Sanders has a proposal for the delinkage of R&D costs from product prices in the HIV market. He has actually several proposals, but I'm going to start with this one so I can kind of walk through the details. And it's also one that he mentioned during his campaign for president in his position paper on HIV. Next slide. So what he proposed is a prize fund for HIV. And I'm going to take a bit of a deep dive on this right now. Now the context of this is about over 36 million people living with HIV worldwide. In the United States, there's about 1.2 million people. And that number is growing every year. I remember when it was under 200,000, I think. Some in the room I hear know here that can remember that very well, or several people. And that was before there was effective drugs for that, and the number was pretty stable because people were getting infected, but they were dying very predictably. Now, because people don't die when they take ARV drugs, the population, so now we have 1.2 million people, the number is going up for people living with HIV. The total antiretroviral sales were 13.4 billion in the United States in 2015, which surprised me. It was almost a 14% increase from the year before. It was a big, I don't know what the numbers are this year, but they're going up. The other thing I think is important is that the NIH spends about $3 billion a year for a couple of decades. It was 10% of the NIH budget when it was devoted by rule to HIV research. USG and I have got a few numbers because I'm going to refer to them later, but it's important to note that we're about 22% of the world GNI, gross national income these days, and about 35% of the OECD share of sort of developed country income. In the past 29 years, the FDA has approved 29 new molecular entities, ARV drugs to treat HIV. So we're getting about one new drug, pretty steady. It's actually the rate of innovations, I think it's reasonably steady, about one new drug per year. Now I want you to think about this. Worldwide, last year, we spent $24 billion on ARV drugs. US alone, over $13 billion, almost $14 billion. How much was it last year? Let me go back. $13.4 billion, over $13 billion. And for that, we get like one new drug per year is what we're getting out of that process. It's a very expensive process right now. And recognizing that on top of everything else, the NIH is throwing $3 billion a year toward research. The U.S. government can acquire generic versions of patented drugs from FDA-approved suppliers for less than 1% of the average wholesale price in the United States. This is a slide on a triplo, which is a very important combination therapy. It's a triple therapy. And Medicare outlays were $590 million last year just for Medicare alone. The Medicare expenditures per patient are $20,960. It's actually the cost was per patient per year is more than that, because in any given year some patients are entering or departing the treatment cycle. So that's sort of a little under what the average patient. The good RX discount prices you can find today on the internet are around $30,000 for that cocktail. The best generic price outside the United States is about $100, and that's not per month, that's per year. So what you're paid for an HIV cocktail is almost all, you can buy this drug for less than $10 a month, just to put it in perspective, but you're paying about $2,500 a month for this drug. So that's what the markup looks like on this particular drug, which is quite important. So what is the motivation for end product prices? One, you want to improve the efficiency of incentives, you want to expand access, and we want to try and save money too. Now, earlier there was a question about whether or not price regulation would be a good approach, and I think that's the competitor to this radical reform, is just do a better job of regulating the monopoly. I can ask you how regulation monopoly is working out for you these days, use the sort of Sarah Palin expression, but from our perspective, you suck at regulating the monopoly. I think it's the other way around. I think the monopoly regulates the government, not the government regulating the monopoly these days. And I think that you have to take into account that that policy failures in regulating the monopoly are not trivial, they're not unexpected, and they're related to the fact that my wife, Manon, was in the first panel, she mentioned that $60 billion went to Roche for Herceptin. That's about $500 million a month, per month. What political problem could Roche not solve with $500 million a month? And that's just one product for Roche, and that's just one drug company. So that gives you an idea why you have some political problems, I think. So here's a quote from a fictional character, sometimes inaccurately ascribed to Socrates, but it was a fictional Socrates who worked in a garage. The secret of change is to focus all of your energy not on fighting the old, but on building the new. And so that's what this meeting's about. It's not about doing a better job of regulating the monopoly. It's about what you can do to replace the monopoly. Now, Senator Sanders and myself are more favorable to capitalism than Dean Baker is today. So we're not quite as fond of the idea of the state directing all the resources for research. We're not very fond of the private sector directing all the resources for research either. We think it's a good idea to have different bodies like the government itself and investors playing different roles in the system. We like an ecosystem that has the advantages of different things. One of the advantages of having investors with their own skin in the game is they can pursue unconventional approaches, different approaches, they can act faster, they can mobilize resources. They can do things that are hard to do in a bureaucratic system. And there's a decentralization that we like. On the other hand, what we don't like are all the negative parts of the thing. So what Senator Sanders has done in his bill is to try and mobilize the advantages of the market system without the disadvantage of the grant monopoly by not granting monopolies. And that is really, I think, the challenge he describes. And I think you'll see that he's solved the problems that he thinks are so insoluble with this process. Now, this thing basically walks through the sort of beginning of the bill. He describes this bill as in paragraph 11 of the findings as delinkage research and development incentives from product prices. And by eliminating legal monopolies to sell new medicines for the treatment of HIV/AIDS, it is possible to induce investments that are medically more important, produce products at lower prices from competitive suppliers, and induce more efficient incentives for R&D. So how does he do that? Creates this prize fund. How much does he want to fund that? He proposed the U.S. put 2% of U.S. GDP. No, not 2%. That's actually a mistake. It's 0.02%. Why I really shouldn't have had that slide wrong. It's 0.0002 GDP. The important thing you have to know is it would be in 2015, it would have been $3.6 billion was reported. Now, some of you have probably heard this idea of the DeMasi study about how much it costs to develop a new drug. DeMasi, rightfully criticized study of exaggerating the cost of the industry of drug development, came up with a number of $2.6 billion, which was a billion less than this number. And a couple of things I have. This does not count the $3 billion per year that the NIH puts toward our research and development, none of which were taken into account in the DeMasi model at all. It doesn't take into account what the rest of the world would put up for the drug. But as we go on, I just want to let you know that since the starting point is the government, as the U.S. government and the private sector combined are putting up over $13 billion a year, our attitude is, if you think $3.6 billion is too low, why don't you just double it? Because you're not going to hit 13 before you do quite a bit of work there. So anyway, the idea is he puts serious money on the table that's related to what you currently see, which is the production of one new molecular entity today. Where does it come from? He wanted the money to come from the people, the federal government, and each covered entity engaged in the business of providing health insurance, which was a health insurer at the table here, so I've got to be careful how I explain this here. So how are the allocations made? Well, collectively, non-federal entities shall be responsible for their share of the persons receiving treatment from HIV. Not individually, but if you look at all the private sector and all the covered entities, all the people that provide insurance, and you compare them to the federal government, just to make it simple, if 30% of the patients were on some kind of private sector program and 70% were on the U.S., in a U.S. program, then U.S. government programs would pay 70% of the cost of the prize fund money, and the private insurers would put up 30%. But for an individual within the companies themselves, it would not be based on their patients, it would be based on their premiums and how they were compared to others. And small plans got a break. If you're under 25 million, you pay nothing into the fund. If you're between 25 and 50, you just pay 50%. You'd have kind of a break on that. How do you get money out of the fund? Well, each developer for a new AIDS drug would qualify for annual payments from the prize fund for a period of 10 years. They'd have 10 paydays. What would the criteria be? Well, one issue would be the number of patients who benefit from the qualifying treatment. Then the next issue would be the incremental therapeutic benefit of the drug compared to existing drugs. And then the improved efficiency for manufacturing process would also be a qualifying contribution. And then there's another issue of the extent to which knowledge, data, materials, and technology are openly shared or contributed to success. This is a topic, this last one, number four, will be discussed by Deanne Singroy and responded to by Jonathan Wilbanks in the next panel on the looking at the open source dividend. By the way, the open source dividend is designed to address this privacy, this secrecy issue that Dean Baker raised in this panel, which we think is a serious problem, so does Senator Sanders, and which is why he proposed, which will be described in the next panel, an economic incentive to be open as opposed to closed, to reduce secrecy and increase sharing. On the other hand, I want to just say that The problem you have with secrecy right now is a big problem in the patent system, in the current system. That's, you observe a lot of that. So you have to ask yourself, is the price system going to do better or worse than the granted monopoly? It's true that if you were just doing everything through directed funding, you'd have more options if that was your system. And to the extent that you have a big role for the public sector in funding research, you do have options to push things more into the public domain, and I think you should do that. But it's not as if Sanders hasn't put incentives for deal with the secrecy thing into his bill. So the additional priorities, follow-on products, this is a really important idea, don't erode the benefits of the first in the class. So under the Sanders bill, if you were to put a product on the market and somebody comes along with a follow-on product that's a little bit better than the existing product, or a lot better, whatever, but if it's based on the same basic technology, suppose you're the first in a new therapeutic class, for example, and if you look at what happened in protease inhibitors, the first drugs, and then other people would kind of follow on, if you establish the benefits and things like that, that even if your market share goes to zero, you would continue to get payments out of the fund if you could show that the follow-on products had stood on your shoulders in some ways. Then there's the 50% rule. That is to say that the no single product would get more than 50% any given year, no matter how good it was. There was, in this previous slide, can I go back to the one before this? I'm changing to my computer. I don't realize that I'm not in control of the screen. I'm sorry for that. When you have products that enter the market at roughly the same time as, I guess that's an additional requirement, yeah. If the products, also if the, there's one I didn't put in here, but that if the products reach, there's a benchmarking that takes place in the price fund, which is you compare the benefits to products that are already in the market. And so Dean Baker, when he looked at an early version of this bill in 2005, he criticized it because he said that what if your products were roughly coming to the market at the same time? So the current version of the bills, since Dean improved the bill, was to say that if products were registered at roughly the same time, they would be considered benchmarked against something earlier, not against each other. So there is that, was that adjustment. And we look forward to other constructive comments from Dean on all these issues because he's very insightful. Okay, so there's additional features. As I mentioned, the open source dividend, there's the issue of competitive intermediaries, which will be talked about, which is also in the bill by Tim Hubbard, who's up in the stand, and he'll be making a presentation later. And there was another provision to deal with foreign global health problems, where the government would actually mobilize some of its resources in a certain way to reduce the open licensing of HIV drugs in developing countries. So it was quite an achievement. There's lots of other prize fund proposals. For example, S627 and the 113th Congress, which was a big thing, would affect not just HIV drugs, but it would have affected all pharmaceutical drugs on the market, much more ambitious. The Cancer Prize Fund, which we discussed, I think, in Geneva in January, is an idea that clubs of countries could move together to demonopolize cancer drugs and fund rewards based on a fraction of the cancer treatment budget that would go to reward drug developers, but they'd get the drugs for, like as generics very cheap. The Chagas Price Fund by some Latin American countries, various products and antibiotics which we've heard about. There's a law, there's a wide range of diagnostic price proposals, and many others have been bandied around, including various proposals that Aidan Hollis has done outside of antibiotics. Progressive delinkage, this is my, I think, almost at the end here. Progressive delinkage, I just want to mention this. That's the idea that you wake up in the morning and you say, you know, I really think it's unsustainable where we're going. The population's getting older, prices are out of control. If we just talk about negotiating prices but without dealing with the way to really have the ability to set with the prices, you're just gonna have restrictions on access like you observe around the world right now. So why don't we just move to the new system? But it's scary to do it right away. So why don't we set the goal that we wanna be in the new system down the road? But the road to the new system will be a progressive implementation that will de-emphasize high prices and will build up these other mechanisms of funding R&D, direct funding, increasing R&D subsidies, cash rewards, things like that. I think I've exceeded my time, and I apologize for that. For more information, we have a webpage called delinkage.org, which was not really complete, but it has a lot of information. And that's my personal email. Thank you very much.
Next up, we have our respondents. The first one is Patrick from the U.S. Chamber of Commerce.
Jamie, you know, you invited me here this morning knowing I would bring a different point of view, and you know, I want to say how much I appreciate the integrity that that invitation represents, so thank you. And thank you, Sarah, for moderating. You know, I also very much, in sharing a different point of view, respect that everyone in the room is working towards ends that we all share. How do we facilitate a system that brings more innovative products to more people in a faster time? So in the time I have, I want to try to do two things. First, to respond to a few of the points that each of the panelists raised, and then just to spend a quick minute responding to some of the broader themes of delinkage. You know, to start, you know, Aidan, I thought you laid out a very interesting sort of run through of the different options that are available in terms of prize funds. I see challenges with, you know, you sort of dismissed the profitability piece. I see challenges with both cost and value-based prizes, but I think that they could be a tremendous asset to the system as a supplement to a patent system, but not as a substitute. Joe, you know, your timeline, you showed a slide on the timeline to profitability. It struck me, one of the things that struck me about it was not just that it took 23 years to achieve a profit, but that the slide seemed to assume a term of patent restoration for marketing or regulatory delays, which is something, you know, the activist community has really tried to prevent in international markets. And you know, this chorus of No Trips Plus, it would certainly affect the profitability of many of those drugs and maybe you know, prevent bringing new ones to market. But I really liked hearing both you and Jamie talked about push incentives. I think that's a tremendously important part of getting attention to neglected diseases, to orphan drugs, finding ways to incentivize research in the areas that currently aren't seeing enough attention. And then I'm going to come back to this one, but Joe, the way you talked about delinkage is different from the way I understand most of the people in the room to be talking about it. You know, Jamie, in setting this up, you framed it as delinking cost from prices. Joe, you talked about delinking revenue from consumption. I think those are, there's an important distinction to be made there. And then, you know, Dean, patents are protectionism. I have to approach it differently. Patents are a property right. And the market distortion is that we limit the property right in the case of intellectual property, whereas if the company invests in bricks and mortar or capital equipment, they own it forever. No one, you know, really disputes that. So you know, I draw a fundamental distinction there. You know, Jamie, you noted this is an expensive process with limited returns. I think that's the core, right? We have research and development testing to bring innovative drugs to market that we all know needs to be done. Ultimately, we have a question of who is going to pay for it. And you know, delinkage is one way to separate the cost from moving from the end user to more of a society-wide basis. Insurance is a form of delinkage. Now, there are many ways to approach this. And what I now want to get to in terms of the broader process is how you can leverage the private sector better to get the outcomes that you want. Because I do think fundamentally it would be a mistake to try to limit the private sector role in innovation. Private sector brings some things that the public sector never will. First of all, that, you know, the free market is the single best means the world has ever found to mobilize resources and to allocate them to things that people really care about. You know, it's an essential mechanism of markets. Second, you know, when you have a private sector approach to an issue, you have competing ideas within a firm, within a an industry. They'll have many different ways of attacking the same problem. You know, in the ideal situation, the best wins out. Third, private sector can take risks that the public sector simply can't. And that's part of mobilizing a much larger pool of wealth than is available to governments. And the reward then is based on the risk. There has to be a risk-reward calculus. And finally, the successes pay for failures. Dean, you talked about the case of the fire engine showing up and having to negotiate a price. The challenge here, I think, in the innovative medicine space is the house is on fire, we don't have a fire engine, someone's inventing it. And yes, you do have to figure out how to pay for it. So that's an important difference. Within biopharma innovation, specifically, the rate of failure is so much higher than in any other industry. I think 12% of molecules that are brought to the FDA win approval, and only 2 in 10 of those earn back the average cost of R&D. So what you have is a fraction of a fraction paying for the whole pipeline. And not only that, but the reinvestment in what comes next. Intellectual property rights. I think it would be a fundamental mistake if we only focused on patents as a reward for innovation that has already taken place. I see it differently. I see the patent system operating to facilitate, to catalyze innovation by providing a property right and a degree of legal certainty that goes with it that enables entrepreneurs, startups, scientists to invest their time, their money, their energies into, and it could be health sciences, it could be technology, it could be movies and music. But the existence of the IP system enables those authors, artists, inventors, researchers to invest their time and energy to attract financing because there is a legal enforceable right associated with it and take a product to market. And when you don't have that, I think the evidence is clear that where there are strong intellectual property systems in place around the world, you see far more innovative output, creative output, than in countries where it's lacking. And I think to not recognize that basic connection and correlation would be a mistake. And then finally, in terms of the high costs of drugs, we're in an era where we have a problem that we want to have. We're getting cures, we're getting treatments that for diseases that were untreatable just a few years ago, but they cost a lot of money. And you got to figure out how to pay for them. Well, that's a challenge for everyone. And to me, the answer is simply innovate more. And yesterday at the Forbes Health Summit, there was an announcement of a deal between Pfizer and IBM to use big data, Watson, to help drive cures. I sincerely believe that we're sort of at a moment in time when there's a particular hurdle. The cost of technology is extremely high, excessively high perhaps in some cases, but we're on the verge of getting over that hump and to move away from the very system that has enabled the advancements that we've already achieved would be a tragic mistake. So, I want to encourage everyone here to just think about, are there ways that we can make the private sector a better partner, whether it's through push and pull incentives? I absolutely think there are great options there. But don't lose sight of what's actually worked to bring important innovations to market. Thanks, Jim.
And last up, we have James McGee from the Transit Employers Health and Welfare Fund. I'm sure a lot of people.
Thank you very much. My name is James McGee. I'm the Executive Director of the Transit Employees Health and Welfare Fund. The Transit Employees Health and Welfare Fund provides the medical, pharmacy, and other welfare benefits for the 8,500 active and 3,500 retired members of ATU Local 689 that are employed by Metro. about 75% of WMATA's workforce. I want to thank the organizers of this event for allowing me to express my viewpoints, which I hope reflect the viewpoints of most in the plan sponsor community, not really the insurer community, but the plan sponsor community. I like to think of the insurers as the people who are spending our money. So despite the advances of the Affordable Care Act to extend coverage to millions of America, employment-based coverage continues to see slippage, both in the percentage of employers offering coverage and the number of employees covered. The major threat to that system is cost, and the major driver of those costs currently is pharmacy cost. Nevertheless, as mysterious and illogical as this employment-based healthcare system might seem to some of our foreign representatives here today, it still represents the major source of healthcare coverage for working Americans and their families. If any of you came to this event by Metro, you encountered some of our employees. We offer a comprehensive set of benefits to our bus and subway operators, maintenance employees, clerical, and others. Why? Because they need them. Research has demonstrated that public sector or public transit employees are among the sickest in the workforce. We have number one highest population rates in hypertension, diabetes, cardiovascular disease, and depression. Most of these conditions can be managed with the effective use of lifestyle and medications. And that is reflected in the fact that our dispensing rate is considerably higher than the average book of business. In the past several years, the trustees of the plan have done an admirable job of keeping overall trend below 5%. And that is in spite of consistent double-digit or near double-digit increases in pharmacy prices. For example, our total plan of benefits, so our budget for 2017 is about $165 million. That's about a 4.2% increase over 2016. And that is in spite of the fact that over the last 4 years, we've experienced 13% annual increase in prescription drugs. It's not my expertise, and it's not my intent to express an opinion on the specific proposals here today on the linkage. Rather, I'd like to put this in the context of the overall problem of rising prices. Delinking R&D costs from the prices charged by manufacturers for drugs may take away one excuse for raising prices, and perhaps a particularly effective and sanctimonious one. But I'm extremely skeptical that it will eliminate the shell game that is pharmacy pricing today. Banning couponing, whereby manufacturers offer coupons designed to circumvent the drug copay structure designed to steer patients to more cost-effective medications. It may save the member money, but it costs plan sponsors like ourselves billions. Medicare and Medicaid do not allow it. Why should we, as private payers, be subject to this abuse? Restricting the ability of pharmaceutical manufacturers to evergreen their patents. Banning rebates, which are no more than an elaborate kickback scheme. Limit price increases. It speaks volumes about the lack of effective market forces to control prices. When a review of our plan's utilization reveals over 220 medications with cost increases in excess of 25% in 1 year. I've yet to hear a plausible explanation for raising the prices of a drug after its release other than because we can. Do these businesses lack any sense of morality or decency? Do we actually think that R&D costs are behind the dramatic price increases of Mylan's EpiPen, that Curing invested lots of R&D money in Daraprim that justifies the 5,000% price increase. And who pays the obscenely high prices? Touches a little bit on Jamie's case. In our case, the members pay about 21% of the premium cost, plus an additional amount for copays. But the bulk of the money is paid by the employer, the Washington Metropolitan Area Transit Authority. And where do they get their money? They get their money from the ratepayers who ride the system and from the taxpayers in Maryland, DC, and Virginia. That's why I sort of take exception to these kind of self-feeding proposals of taxing the insurance companies. A lot of that was evidence in the Affordable Care Act. So what are our politicians doing to protect us from these price gouging schemes? I'm waiting.
Hi, so my name is Yasera, and I'm the scientific and technical advisor at KEI. And so I will be introducing the concepts behind open source dividends and providing some examples on how it can be implemented and some concrete examples of open source research. So generally, for scientific research to be considered open, the information surrounding the acquisition of the data must be known, and this data must, of course, be accessible in a non-discriminatory way and usable by others, that is, can be reused, distributed, and analyzed. And so this brings value to society because it can benefit more people who can then analyze the data, and there can be more collaborations. The data can also be scrutinized. And it can also prevent unnecessary repetitions of experiments on human and animals. So currently, there's a strong commercial incentive to restrict research by patenting research or keeping the information private in order to obtain the financial benefits associated with licensing of the knowledge, materials, or technology. And this vested interest can come at a cost that is at the cost of what is most beneficial for society. So as a consequence, progress is slowed down when research is conducted in silos. The cost of conducting the business is increased because using patented knowledge can lead to litigations. Experiments that don't work, for example, are rarely published, causing others to repeat the same mistakes. And of course, the health needs that are affected by a small number of people or small markets are not necessarily prioritized. So an example of a policy that closes scientific research is the Dole Act, and this expanded the ability of private parties to patent and hold exclusive rights to inventions that were developed using government funds. So the barriers to open access could be removed with open source dividends, which can be part of an innovation inducement prize model as part of a full delinkage model. And so there are three parts to implementing an innovation inducement prize, but briefly, so an end product prize rewards successful development of products that reaches consumer, however defined. And these are different than other prizes in three ways. First, timing of the remuneration, the nature of the innovation, and also this is most closely competes with patent monopolies. Interim prizes reward narrow and specific solutions to technical issues. It can be given to those who achieve a pre-established goal in the development of a new technology, or to solutions that contribute the most to advancing the larger objective. And so open source dividends work to counter the stifling effects of Bayh-Dole Act. And so currently there is, as I said before, there's little market incentive to reward the open source research and sharing. And so open source dividend programs can better align the private incentives with public interest. So they are prizes that reward and encourage sharing and collaboration, of scientific research. And so they designed to create an economic incentive to share knowledge, material, technology that are judged to have been helpful or instrumental to the success of the end product. And these dividends can be funded in two ways. As seen in the federal legislative proposals by Senator Sanders, a portion of the innovation inducement prize could be allocated to persons who openly share knowledge, material, and technologies that were deemed useful for development of the winning prize product. But it can also be implemented as a completely separate entity, for example, as a percentage of drug sales. And so open source dividends can revolutionize incentives to open and share information. It can be implemented without reform, and it lowers the initial costs of acquiring the intellectual property. And so the drug developers also benefit from this. They benefit by having access to the royalty-free knowledge, but they also pay for it through sharing of the revenue. And so an example of how to implement the open source dividends is through the Sanders Prize Fund Bill. At around 2004, Senator Sanders, CP Tech, and others first drafted the Medical Innovation Prize Fund Bill and introduced this bill to the House of Representatives in 2005. The original bill was aimed at the entire U.S. market for FDA approval prescription drugs. Later on, Senator Sanders reintroduced the bill, the latest one being in 2013, with various modifications as two new versions of the prize fund. And among these changes was the introduction of the open source dividend elements to the bill. And so the goal is to eliminate monopolies on new drugs and use the prizes to induce the innovation that are responsive to health needs. And so the reward would then act as a substitute for the granting of the monopoly. So to be eligible, one must openly share knowledge in a royalty and non-discriminatory manner. And the size of the prize, along with the recipients to be selected based on the impact of the innovation. So that is the number of people who would be affected, the magnitude of the innovation, if it addresses priority health needs, if it contributes to development of the therapeutic product, and of course, how the sharing is done, so open, non-discriminatory, and royalty-free. The shares of the open source dividends would be allocated based on the evaluation performed by an appointed panel of jury. So here is an example of the text from the open source dividends prize section, so section 9 of Senator Sanders Prize Fund for HIV Act from 2013. And so within this bill, there are a couple of ways that we can propose to fund the open source dividend. So keep in mind that the GDP of the US in 2015 was just over $18 billion, and the NIH budget was $30.3 billion. So the 626 Act, the annual funding for this is 0.05 of 0.0055 of GDP, and this is around $4.96 billion, which is equivalent to only 16% of last year's NIH budget. The 627 Act is 0.00001 of the GDP, which is only about $180 million. And a standalone open source dividends at current levels of drug spending would get just over $4 billion for every percent of drug sales. So in a nutshell, this is an example of how it can be done. And so I will just end by giving concrete examples of Eastern academia, how we use open source science. And so in HIV, we have these databases. This one is the Stanford database, and there's also Los Alamos database, and they collect HIV sequences from patients from all over the world. And with this, we can then track HIV drug resistance. And here we see a map that is generated based on this freely accessible data. And this is enormously important for public health programs and especially for prescribing practices. Another really great database is the protein data bank. And again, it collects, people can submit protein sequence information and X-ray crystallography information. So that's kind of like that big enzyme you see in the corner, the 3D structure of protein. And from that, what we were able to do is we can do modeling of the HIV proteins that are affected by drugs and look at these proteins that are drug resistant versus the ones that are not drug resistant. And in gray, we can see the ones that are resistant to dolutegravir. And we can see how does it interact with the host genome and then figure out how to make better drugs like carbotegravir, for example, or bictegravir, for example, and who are less susceptible to drug resistance. In the color, actually, you can see in yellow a new inhibitor that we've, these are called docking experiments, and there we can see how it will interact also with the HIV proteins. And again, this, to be able to do all these kind of modeling data, we pulled from freely accessible data from the PPD. And so I will finish with this. So the Montreal Neurological Institute is releasing all its results and all its data from its biobank and from its brain scans. And this institute will not pursue patents on any of its discoveries. And any organization that then collaborates with the NMI will also have to follow open science principles. So this is the first time that it's been done on an institutional level. The examples before were driven by governments. But this one is at an institutional level, and so they're developing metrics to measure this, and in 5 years we'll see where it was a very interesting example of implementing open source. And so I will end with the quote of Dr. Guy Rouleau, who's the director of the MNI. And he says that there's a fair amount of patenting by people at the institute already, but the outcomes have not been very useful, adding that the institute would rather provide data that others could use to develop medicines. But importantly, it comes down to what is the reason for our existence? Is it to accelerate science? It's to accelerate science, not to make money. And I think this is pretty clear that the current for-profit model that is linking profitability of medicines to research is at odds with scientific progress, thus the development of future therapies and diagnostics.
We'll hear from John Wilbanks, who's with Sage BioToneWorks, the Kauffman Foundation, and Faster Cures as a respondent. Respondents get a little less time than the speakers to respond. Do you want the PowerPoint left up for
Okay.
So first, I'd like to thank KEI for having me here, and I'm grateful to Dr. Singer to respond. I don't know a lot about open source dividends, and I don't work on the drugs pricing and business model issue. I come more from the open science world that Dr. Singer talked about at the beginning of her talk. Sage BioNetworks is a nonprofit organization based in Seattle. We spun out of Merck, actually, in 2009. Some of the trends mentioned in the previous panel about drug companies not investing in the discovery side is one of the reasons why we spun out, because we were the molecular profiling and discovery unit of Merck, and rather than divest it in a sale, we were able to negotiate its exit into a nonprofit. And we exist at the center of multiple novel efforts that are trying to do open science. So we serve as the coordinating center for the National Cancer Institute's Network of Systems Biology Centers, for the Accelerating Medicines Partnership for Alzheimer's Disease, which is a public-private partnership of the drugs industry and the NIH, the Cancer Genome Atlas, and any other number of efforts. We also run about 10 mobile clinical studies that run entirely through phones in partnership with Apple and other sets of groups. So we have a lot of experience dealing with open science, and what we see is that, for the most part, the issues in science tend to be cultural. Scientists don't get trained how to collaborate or share. They don't grow up with open architecture like programmers do. And so they have to have a fair amount of hand-holding to get towards open science. And so I'm going to use the Accelerating Medicines Partnership for Alzheimer's as my example. And I'll say AMP to not have to say that every time because it's a tongue twister. But AMP is now in its third session of funding, its third wave of funding. And the concept behind AMP is we keep screwing up Alzheimer's drugs, right, badly. They all fail. And so rather than fund a single group or a single company to investigate the next drug targets for Alzheimer's, the idea was to fund six groups that had radically different ideas from each other with public-private investment, let them work privately in competition with each other to encourage diversity of hypothesis formation. Because what we found is when we go open at the very beginning, everyone converges on the most popular hypothesis and just iterates on it. So allowing some privacy at the very beginning and some enclosure at the very beginning actually helps stimulate more crazy ideas to be formed. However, once there's a certain point that hits, those six groups have to share everything with each other and the entire consortium. The community collectively selects the best targets, and then everything gets pushed out to the public domain. And the second point is that it's increasingly possible to find the undiscovered scientific geniuses who power a lot of these things, but don't get rewarded. These are people who make reagents. These are people who annotate and clean data. These are people who share code. That's not typically considered Nobel-worthy work. And these people have to either free ride on other people in the lab who do the actual writing, or they have to get out of the business. And the existence of something like a dividend, a place where those individuals could at least see a path towards some glory and some money, that doesn't require going through traditional sausage-making and grant-making process is really interesting. Because you know, open source and open science have depended on altruism and philosophical buy-in, and that's great. But if you look at the history of open source and software, it scaled when it became something that was considered a methodological success that had the opportunity of actually paying some salaries. That's when it really hit scale in the late 90s. And so my hope would be that if we can find a way to bring these dividends into being, that we can begin to connect the open science movement from really the access to medicines movement, because we've been historically a little too far apart. And these kinds of dividends are the path that I think can help us start to come together. Thank you.
And he hit 7 minutes too. We'll next hear from who's with Medicine Sans Frontier, and she'll talk about TB drugs.
Great. Thank you very much for having me here today. It's been a really inspiring and uplifting morning after, potentially less inspiring time. So I'm putting up the kind of tagline of the 3P project to start, and I'll keep coming back to this tagline because once I explain how TB treatment works today, you'll see why that's such a revolutionary idea. So the 3P project of push, pull, and pull is about getting a 1 month or less treatment for TB that works for everyone, everywhere. So in order to explain why this is important, I'll start by saying a bit about my own organisation. So I work with Judit Rius at Médecins Sans Frontières, Doctors Without Borders, in the Access Campaign. As MSF, we're the largest non-governmental provider of drug-resistant TB care globally. And we treat around 2,000 patients with drug-resistant TB each year. This picture up here is of Fumeza, who was diagnosed at the age of 22 with extensively drug-resistant TB. Extensively drug-resistant TB has a 13% chance of being cured on existing treatments. The drugs we have are so bad that the majority of people who adhere to the treatment and take it will not be cured at the end point and will die regardless of the fact that they adhere to the treatment. Fumeza was one of the lucky 13%. She's alive today and doing really well. But one of the consequences of the drugs that she took to cure her TB was that she permanently lost her hearing. She became completely deaf and unable to hear anything at all in the outside world. And that was not a consequence of tuberculosis. that was a consequence of the treatment for tuberculosis, which is incredibly poor, basically unacceptable today. So drug-resistant TB is a global problem. This just shows you where XDR-TB cases have been found globally. So it's really all over the world. This is back in 2012, and I'm sure the picture's probably got worse since then. The problem with TB is really one that connects to this idea of delinkage and to open science. So some of the things that Diane was just speaking about in terms of silo development of just, because with TB we need at least four drugs to be used in combination with each other to treat a patient. We're never going to get one single drug that's the blockbuster cure. And so this idea of silo development, where each company privately pursues one drug lead on their own, means that we're not getting the best that we could out of the science, because everyone is failing in secret, but they're also not looking at what are the best possible combinations of novel therapies together. And it's led to a situation today where we have the first new TB drugs in 50 years, bedaquiline and delaminid, and both of these drugs are now on the market, and yet we still do not know, and we will not know before 2020 at the earliest, how best and whether we can actually use these drugs in combination, because they were pursued completely separately, and the drug-drug interaction studies, we do not have reports on that yet, and we don't know whether these novel drugs can be used together. So silo development, secretive, closed science has not brought the breakthroughs we need for TB. The other issue, which is very clear delinkage issue, is that TB affects patients who are too poor to constitute a rational investment for private companies if they are looking to get high prices and monopolies as a means of recouping their investment and making a profit. As we saw from the previous panel and the presenter from BARDA, companies are looking at what is the net present value, what return on investment am I going to get? And when we're looking at TB treatments, we're talking about people primarily in countries where they cannot afford to pay high prices. And so the investment is not flowing. So there's an issue around needing to increase funding levels overall, both public funding and private funding. We have to acknowledge that the incentive structures don't deliver, both in terms of patents not being an adequate incentive and monopolies not being a good incentive to drive that investment. That's why the investment's not there. But also this siloed approach not being what is in the best interest of science and what's in the best interest of patients, which is to have a combination regimen. So what do we need? We need to bring new researchers and developers to look at the problem. We haven't got enough minds focusing on this problem. We need to re-engage the traditional investors. Pretty much all of Big Pharma has exited the field of TB. We have some charitable work and sort of CSR work going on in Otsuka, in GSK, and in Eli Lilly. But the majority of large pharmaceutical firms are not working in TB drug development, despite the really clear medical need to get better treatments. So we need to re-engage some traditional investors. We need a healthy drug pipeline. If we're going to get four novel treatments in order to get a breakthrough that would give us this 1 month or less cure for everybody everywhere, and get rid of categories of drug resistance because we'd have a novel regimen that would work for all patients. And we're not going to get that with the current pipeline we have, which has about one drug in phase one development, a few compounds in preclinical, and one or two exiting clinical trials at the moment. And that situation has not changed over the last 15 years, that the pipeline is barren, and it needs to completely be revolutionised if we're going to get the treatments we need. And then also we need an open collaborative framework that enables several drugs to be developed in parallel as part of a combination regimen, not in silos as individual drugs, to slightly improve the standard of care that we have today. And that's the current approach. Add one new drug to an existing regimen. But the regimen is 2 years long, it has toxic side effects, and it's only for MDR, it's only curing 50% of patients, and for XDR, it's curing 13%. So this incremental approach is failing patients. So what is the 3P project? It's an idea that MSF, or Doctors Without Borders 3, got behind, but alongside others in the TB community who are completely convinced that we need to have a new way, a delinked way of doing TB research and development if we're going to deliver on the goals we have. It puts science and the patient at the core rather than being the afterthought. and it rewards the best science, ensuring collaboration so that treatments that work for all are developed quickly. So it's about expediting and really accelerating the time it's going to take to get the treatment we need. And to reiterate, we want to go from a two-year treatment that only works for 50% of patients and has horrible toxic side effects to a one-month or less cure that works for everyone, everywhere. How does it do it? What are these three P's? So it's a mixture of incentives and managing and sharing of IP. So this has been talked about quite a lot already this morning. Basically using push funding to finance research and development activities up front through grants. Using pull incentives or financial rewards to achieve specific objectives in the form of milestone prizes. And pooling intellectual property and data so that we have an open collaborative research and fair licensing for affordable products. And here's a nice, well, I quite like it, schematic of how this would actually look. So it's about, we've kind of broken down the research and development pipeline of how compounds move along the chain from discovery, preclinical research, and then the clinical development or the point when you're trialing these drugs in humans. And the idea of the big star you see in the middle is to put a large milestone prize at phase one entry for any compound that's been developed where the owners of that compound are prepared to license it through a medicines patent pooling mechanism for anyone, any researcher who is interested in developing regimens for TB to take forward and combine novel compounds in a regimen trial. So you have basically incentivizing early stage research to take place, and then paying or incentivizing that research to then enter the public domain. So anyone who would receive, it's about making strings attached, putting conditions on funding. If you want to get a prize from the 3P project, and that prize is a significant financial reward, we're looking around 50 million per compound, then there are conditions. You have to license your IP so that other scientists can also make use of this research, and you need to share all your data so that we know everything possible that we need to be able to know about those compounds and how they work. And then we use push funding or grant funding to actually pay for the clinical trials, because the clinical trials are the most expensive part of this value chain. But in the area of TB, which is perhaps different from many other areas of drug research, those clinical trials today are being carried out by academic groups and consortia. So we have those organisations in place who are capable of doing the clinical trials, of getting drugs through phases one through three and onto the market. And we do not need to rely on private companies in the same way that perhaps is relied upon in other disease areas. So you're trying to incentivize the private investment early on, and then once you've got these compounds looking promising, they meet the target product profile, so we know that the drugs are ideally suited to be combined in a regimen. You pay for that research, the private investors get a return on their investment, and then you push fund and rely on product development partnerships, public-private partnerships, and research consortia to do the clinical trials. And then at the end point, you do not have high prices because you are not paying for this research and development through sales. You're paying for the research and development up front, and then you're having competitive production at the end point. So to summarize, we're looking to deliver a 1 month or less cure for TB that works for everyone everywhere, which you should get really excited about if you have any experience of TB treatment today. And it's using innovative funding strategies to incentivize collaborative research, awarding prize money for new TB drugs at an early stage, facilitating the early sharing of clinical data and intellectual property so that promising candidates can be combined, and offering grant-based funding to pay for clinical trials and new treatment regimens. And you can visit our website for more information. Just to summarise, we think there are four benefits of this model over the existing system for TB research. The first is that it reduces duplication. By having this open science research and open science approach, you're saving time and you're saving money. You're not making the same mistakes over and over again in private. You're de-risking potential combinations as early and as affordably as possible by publishing what you know about the compounds, doing drug-drug interaction studies early. We can know if novel compounds coming to the market can be combined or not. The status quo, we still do not know for the two new drugs that are on the market whether they can be safely combined. That is a really late stage and a very costly point to be finding out that actually we're not going to get a novel breakthrough regimen with these two new medicines. You're accelerating drug combination development and you're reducing the risk of resistance, because rather than bringing single drugs to the market, you're bringing the drugs to the market as a regimen. So those individual compounds or individual drugs are protected within the regimen. You're not putting one drug on the market, you're putting them together as a package of four, which will really help against fight against future drug resistance. And just to quickly show the organisations involved so far, so MSF is one of the members of the steering committee for this project. We're working with the TB Union, who are taking the lead on doing the project management and the funding of the proposal. The Medicines Patent Pool, who are the IP licensing agency that will do the licensing during the development and also for production. The Stop TB Partnership, who are very interested in this from a communications and advocacy perspective. And then the data pooling or data sharing will be facilitated by the Critical Path Institute. And the WHO is and Global TB team at the World Health Organization are an observer on the board and have been very involved in trying to shape and to come up with the target product profiles of what should the drugs and what do the regimens need to look like from a patient perspective or to get the best for patients. So thank you very much.
Very good. Last we'll hear from Tim Hubbard, who's at King's College London, and he's going to talk about competitive intermediaries for decentralized direct funding.
Thanks very much for inviting me. I'm going to talk really about, I think really about trust, because many real aspect about this, we have a system that sort of works, we don't think it's very efficient, but everything that suggests you want to change that drastically, governments and other players become very worried that actually you're going to produce a system that's worse, that it's not really going to function, because we kind of believe that market incentives do actually drive people to actually get products out the door. So if you go to the next slide, and look at what we've got right now in terms of agencies which manage funding. These are just a few examples from the UK and the US. You know, there's a whole variety actually, and they range from very basic research funders like the NSF, then charity funders like the Wellcome Trust and Howard Hughes, to right at the other end of the spectrum, people. Funders who are funding things much more directly or more with an interest to actually getting a product. Now, how efficiently do these individuals work? Well, I show an example from the Human Genome Project because this is very well known. People tend to think the Human Genome Project was a competition between the funders of academics and the investors in a commercial company. But actually, from being in the inside, the reason why the public project was so efficient in the end was because, next slide, next two slides actually, that's it, yeah. So, no, back, that's it, yes. Was that actually within the NIH and the other funders who were funding it, but principally the NIH and the Wellcome Trust, they forced the data to be open. So every data that got collected, the sequence had to be deposited every 24 hours. There was a little evaluation group sitting in the NIH who were essentially counting what had got into the public databases and later on assessing its quality as well. And that produced this kind of aggressive feedback loop on how well the different people who were collecting the data, and there were multiple groups with five different organizations, how well they were doing. And put huge pressure on them to keep improving their performance. And that was facilitated through weekly conference calls with this evaluation team producing a spreadsheet that was distributed an hour before. So it was the conference calls were not about how impressive I can sound like I'm going to do things. They weren't about, why weren't you producing particularly well this week? Or why is everybody else producing 50% more than you? And so that drove the competition structure. So this is just an example of actually, within these existing funding entities, there is the capacity to apply sort of aggressive metrics around actual delivery of things. So if we go back to this, go back to the next slide. That's it, right, back to this landscape. Actually, this is a set of competitive intermediaries, really, in terms of allocation of funding. And maybe not the optimal one, but they are something that sits between funding basic researchers and some of the ones at this end are closer to funding clinical trials to actually produce research entities. Now, probably what's missing is the element, is this thing up there called NICE. NICE is something that operates in the UK. It's not quite unique. The Australians have something similar. Various other countries have been following it in terms of really evaluating actual health economics metrics around what's the cost of a drug and how well does that intervention work. So in the moment, you've got a kind of separation between upstream funding of things, which actually has some degree of metrics and some competition between those funders of, in terms of the models they use and how they assess how well they're doing in terms of their outputs. But that's not so well aligned to how well does the drug work at the end? What, did we develop any drugs indirectly through this funding? And how good are those drugs in the end? So I think the point I want to make is that we have a landscape of funders set up in a certain sort of way. We could improve that landscape. And in fact, next slide, I could just change the labels of these. And actually, what current big pharma is doing is not a lot dissimilar. They're sitting between the little companies coming up with the new products, as was, has been said before. They're kind of picking and choosing, deciding which to fund, which not to fund. The only difference is they're interested in maximizing profit rather than maximizing health outcome. Of course, NICE is still sitting there evaluating, at least in the UK, evaluating healthcare outcome and producing, you know, enormous news stories when they decide not to take up a drug in that National Health Service because of that. So I think if we could combine some of these elements, we could do better, making maybe some of the academic funders or the kind of the government-directed funders a little more aware of, you know, what's the actual outcome in terms of whether, how many drugs got developed and how good they were. And maybe these, by changing the incentives about what we're prepared to buy, we could probably drive these in the other direction. There is actually a model of where this has happened. So next slide. And that's the transformation. Next slide. Next slide. Sorry, that one. Oh, sorry. Back. Wrong screen. Back one, there. So we actually have done a business model transformation in the publishing world. So that's something where government funds payments for publishers to publish academic research. And up to now, it's been direct funding through subscriptions until the last few years. And of course, that's allowed the publishers to do what they like in terms of putting access controls. That means scientists can only read something, the public can't read it at all, and you can only read it as a scientist if your library is subscribed to it or your institution is subscribed to it. The same money, next slide, changes direction. The same entities exist, the publishers are still there. However, the publishers now have to behave in a different way because they're going to get funded through the academics who are deciding to publish their work there through payment charges. It's the same money. The business model has just changed. The intermediaries in this case between publications and their distribution are those publishers, but those publishers now have to behave in a different way. And I think by, you know, this is all about mechanism design, really. Combination of government regulations about what you're prepared to pay, how systems are prepared to pay for medical outputs, and how you set up your funding agencies to deliver those outputs. You can combine all those things to transform the business model in the direction of delinkage and still make it function, you know, in an efficient way. So this is the kind of counter argument to the people who say the existing system, well, we know it isn't very good, but at least it works, and if you change it radically, there's a risk you destroy everything. I want to make the point that actually it's not quite as bad as that, because actually it's quite a lot of expertise around how to manage these kind of research systems, and we could improve that by changing incentives a bit and drive things in this direction. And I'll stop there. And just, you know, a lot of acknowledgements over the years, many discussions, many, many different organizations, I'm sure, have missed them out. Thank you very much.
I'm going to start with Alan Kabul, who is works with the Medicine Law and Policy and Global Health Unit at the University of Medical Center of Groningen at the University of Groningen in the Netherlands. She's also a member of the Lancet Commission on Essential Medicines Policies, and she specifically contributed to the report that was just very recently launched. So, Alan, thank you.
Good afternoon, and thank you, Judith, for this introduction, and thank you to representatives from all regions of the world. Now, the Commission addressed various aspects of medicines policies. It wasn't only about affordability and about intellectual property, although you cannot escape making it a core if you assess medicines policies, but it also looked at what does it actually cost to provide a basic package. It looked at quality issues, it looked at making medicines affordable, so what are the interventions that governments, for example, can make, and paying attention to developing the missing essential medicines. And when I talk about essential medicines, this is essential medicines as defined by WHO, which is a core set of medicines that will help you to treat the majority of health problems in your population. The WHO also says if you are labeled an essential medicine, you need to be affordable and it needs to be available. Now, recently, the WHO added a number of new essential medicines to the essential medicines list, including, for example, sofosbuvir, known here as Sovaldi, which hammers home the huge challenges globally for making new essential medicines available. Now, the Commission identified following key problems with regard to the current innovation system. I think most of these issues have been discussed already at this panel, so I won't spend a lot of time on that. But clearly, getting a research and development system that focuses on health needs is a huge challenge for the future. That, coupled with making sure that the result of that research and development is actually affordable and accessible to people who need them wherever they live. This is not just a problem of rich countries, although next one, which looks like this, yeah, go a little faster. Can you go to the next slide? Yeah. When I started to work on access to medicines about 15 years ago, it's actually longer ago, but not entirely long, it was very much an issue of development. When you were working on access to medicines, it was always a developing country issue. I'm from the Netherlands, one of the wealthiest countries of the European Union, a union that still exists. We're now experiencing rationing of medicines that are considered essential. So access to essential medicines, and you see the next photograph, this is a demonstration in London actually by cancer patients demanding access to a cancer treatment for kidney cancer. The problem has become a global problem, which also means that the solutions need to be solved at the international level, which of course in the current political climate is a bigger challenge than it perhaps was 15 years ago. Now, we have lessons that can be learned from a host of initiatives that we have seen in the area of neglected diseases. And I will not go into details because I'm assuming that Rachel Cohn from the DNEI will do that, but there are very important lessons, including those related to delinkage models, practical delinkage models, that work very well in that area. But the Lancet Commission also says those are still haphazard. There are individual cases. The fundamental background of what causes a lot of the problems that we see today are not really tackled with it. So we have the lessons, but we're not expanding and applying them more broadly. The One of the areas of attention of the Lancet Commission was the current incentiveness mechanisms for innovation, which always seem to have market exclusivity or expanding market exclusivity or prolonging market exclusivity or creating new market exclusivity at its core. Whenever you bring an R&D problem to the table, the demand from industry is always give us longer patents. We heard it a little bit this morning as well, or give us other market exclusivities. Rare diseases is a very good example of it. This is a list of drugs with orphan status and their global sales figures in 2015, and 7 of the 10 top drugs in global sales actually have orphan status in the US and or in Europe. I think this shows us very clearly that there's something fundamentally wrong in our way of thinking and applying incentive mechanisms for research and development. Another big issue that we discussed was the lack of transparency on the cost of developing a new medicine. One of the speakers this morning said the industry lies. They're often helped by academia to further sort of propagate those lies. But the fact is that a lot of the policymakers actually base their decisions or their reluctance to make good decisions on these figures. While if you look at the situation where we actually do have real data on what it costs to develop a new medicine, they're nowhere near the latest big figure of $2.5 billion that is being peddled by pharma lobbyists. So a strong call for greater transparency with regard to the cost of research and development is important to have more informed policy debates. And it's also important to educate policymakers and to show that there's actually a whole lot more possible than you would think with the money that we today have at our disposal. So back to the Lancet Commission's conclusions can be summarized as followed. The Lancet Commission says we need to move towards a global research and development framework. With the current patent-based innovation system, the feasibility of achieving or maintaining universal health coverage there where it exists is seriously at risk. Business as usual will not resolve the current problems with research and development, and concerted global action is the only way forward. And one of the second recommendation that the Commission makes is for governments in collaboration with the World Health Organization to define a list of priority essential, missing essential medicines. So that you put out a very clear signal saying these are the medicines that are that we are lacking today. There has been some work in the past. This is of course not this does not have to start from scratch, but if that list is agreed, and if the list is not static, clearly this is something that will constantly be revised and it will evolve just like the essential medicines list does. But based on that, you can then start to take measures. The Commission was very taken with the proposals for delinkage. I thank you for your attention. This is where you can find the last Commission reports and the various discussions around it and the Twitter accounts you might want to look at. Thank you.
As Ellen already made clear, the solutions to this problem has to be international. What we're talking about, of course, is an international problem of people's lives, but also the fact that the technology is global. But the most important thing, perhaps, is to recognize is that the rules governing medical technology and access are actually also international, because intellectual property is now part of trade agreements. And therefore, the standards are embedded in trade agreements that have, starting with a multilateral trade agreement of the TRIPS agreement in the WTO, but also proliferating in various bilateral and regional trade agreements that kind of copy one another in terms of the standards. And the enforcement is also global because they are enforced through the dispute settlement mechanisms of the WTO and other dispute settlement mechanisms of these trade agreements, which also tend to copy one another with respect to intellectual property and the disputes between governments, between states and investors, including pharmaceutical companies. So, but now the problem of access to medicines is as I said, you know, a global one, but the other, I think the second important thing to keep in mind is that the interests of different governments, of the public of different countries in the world, and the interest groups that influence the behavior of governments is extremely diverse. You know, Bangladesh that has no patents on medicines to the United States that sort of dominates the field. I think this is a context in which why international agreements, international debates, international consensus on how to deal with the problem of access in this diverse world is extremely important and has to be factored in. And you know, acknowledging that the United States is sort of the most powerful member of this international community in that it is the host country of the biggest pharmaceutical corporations, and probably that dominates the holdings of patents. Of course, China now has taken over the United States and most other countries in patent filings, but I don't think this is the case for the pharmaceuticals. With respect to all of this, these comments that were made about the incentivizing effects of patents, one might actually have a good study. Maybe somebody has done this of the how patents work to intent, or maybe not that necessary to incentivize patent filings. I think an awful lot of that must be publicly funded. This high level panel on access to medicines was an important initiative at the level of the Secretary General in a number of ways. But it was the first time that it was the Secretary General that addressed the question of health and access to medicines. Normally, you would expect it to be a problem that would be dealt with by the World Health Organization or other, or maybe by WIPO, the Intellectual Property Organization. But for the Secretary General to set up a panel is akin to saying that it is the head of state, president or prime minister, setting up a panel on health as opposed to the minister of health. And this then therefore recognizes the fact that access to medicines is not just a health problem, but an economic problem and a general human welfare problem. And that you need to address these the problem from these multiple sectoral points of view and take on board the stakeholders of these different sectors. Our panel of 15 members was actually very diverse, and it included, it was led by very high-level political figures, former presidents of Switzerland and Botswana, and it included, CEO of Glaxo. It included other pharmaceutical manufacturers in the public sector and in the generics sector. And it also included members of the civil society, leading members, scientific community, and general development community as well. Our procedure was to call for contributions, and so we had nearly 200 contributions from academics, from NGOs, from governments, and we held hearings in London and South Africa. And we were backed up by an extraordinarily impressive group of experts who constituted the advisory committee. So it was a very robust process. And I think in a sense, included in it was a sort of a sense of a multi-stakeholder negotiations to come up with the with our conclusions. And therefore, that is the reason why we also propose, therefore, the R&D treaty that has already been, that is already under discussion. But in order to do that, we say that it should, we should start, in fact, with a working group. You know, that the Secretary General should start immediately with setting up a working group to make this this a reality. We also say that on this delinkage will not work without financing, and therefore we need to have new and innovative sources of financing. The taxpayer money from governments is not necessarily going to be forthcoming. And there will, of course, be private contribution, philanthropy, and so forth. But there again, there needs to be a different kind of mechanism for finding financial resources. And for example, the airline taxes and other financial transaction taxes might be a way to go. I want to just conclude by saying, politically, the argument for delinkage, the argument for an internationally coordinated approach is quite different today than what it was 15 years ago. 15 years ago, and I think Ellen has already mentioned this, it was always the problem, the problem of access was always seen as a problem of poverty. The reason why people don't have access is because they are poor. It's poor people living on less than a dollar a day in poor countries. Today we recognize that this is not just a problem of poor countries, this is a problem of the United States. And this is not just, this is because the ratio between incomes and the burden of health spending has shifted. And the second problem is that the nature of the diseases, that the we are no longer talking only about the neglected tropical diseases, but about cancer and other diseases that affect people much more universally. So the political negotiations and the kinds of solutions that are imagined would have to change. And just as a last word, I would say that in terms of the governmental positions, unfortunately, the United States government has been against this our work right from the beginning. They opposed the establishment of the of this panel and has rejected the proposals as being an attempt to destroy the pharmaceutical innovation system based on patents.
This is the unenviable time of day after lunch, before coffee, before interesting people start arriving. While I'm describing a little bit the history of DDI, please jump up, move around, grab coffee if you need to. For those that don't know, DDI, the Drugs for Neglected Diseases Initiative, was actually created by many of the people in this room in 2003 by Doctors Without Borders, Médecins Sans Frontières, MSF, when MSF joined forces with five public sector research institutions in Brazil, India, Kenya, Malaysia, and France. DNDI was created at that time that Ellen and Sekiko have both mentioned, when we sort of used to speak very simply about developing countries and developed countries, about infectious diseases versus non-communicable diseases in a world which felt a little bit more black and white than today's reality. And we were created precisely to develop, to sort of create an alternative model, a different way of researching and developing medicines that would put patients' needs right at the center of the process and eliminate the profit motive altogether. So DDI is a nonprofit research and development group that does research and development in the public interest. Next slide. In its first 10 years, DNDi delivered 6 new products, 2 anti-malarial combination therapies, the first new sleeping sickness treatment in 25 years, a set of combination therapies for visceral leishmaniasis in East Asia and East Africa, and a pediatric dosage form of the drug benzimidazole to treat Chagas disease. Since then, there's been one additional development for pediatric HIV, for infants and young children who are co-infected with HIV and tuberculosis. And I just want to mention that all of the products that have been developed by DNDi and our partners to date are easy to use, meaning they are adapted to the conditions in which patients live. They are affordable. For example, artesunate and amodiaquine, which was our first product, and it's a combination of artesunate and amodiaquine. We worked with an industrial partner, Sanofi, to develop this drug, along with many, many other partners, including MSF, and that treatment is available for $1 per treatment course for adults, 50 cents per treatment course for kids, and more than 450 million doses have been distributed to date. All of our products are non-patented, and I'll kind of come back to our intellectual property policy later and how that governs how we think about IP. We also must have adequate and sustainable, especially, but not only public financing. This of course has to include push funding, but also interesting pull mechanisms like prizes that have been discussed today. And this funding has to be linked to the globally agreed norms that both the HLP report and the Lancet Commission spoke about that are based on this concept of delinkage. So this is kind of the idea of conditioning financing or tying funding to the implementation of this concept of making sure that products are affordable, promoting and incentivizing openness, transparency, and access to knowledge and data, making sure that there's a plan in place for pro-public health, management of intellectual property, and equitable licensing, fostering and promoting scientific and technical cooperation, especially North-South, and working towards some essential regulatory standards. Won't say anything about that. Can you go ahead a little bit? One more? Two more. And this is the last slide. So I think something that's been very difficult in the conversation about innovation, policy, and access to medicines is how to go from the esoteric, from these big discussions we've been having about delinkage and so forth, into practical, concrete steps. How can we actually move beyond the small example of DNDi and the 3Ps project and some of the other interesting initiatives that are the patchwork that Ellen spoke about. We have a lot of interesting lessons across the board, but they're fragmented, they're ad hoc. There is no sustainable framework tying this all together and redefining the rules of the game. Our feeling is that we need to have the global framework, the global treaty, whatever you want to call it, the global agreement that the HLP report recommended. And in the meantime, we have some opportunities to practically apply some of the lessons and principles from all of these policy discussions. Firstly, Judit mentioned it at the very beginning at the high-level meeting on AMR. A political declaration was made there that was very important, echoing some of the recommendations of the HLP report. At the upcoming G20, new money is likely to be put on the table for AMR, possibly for neglected tropical diseases, certainly for pandemic preparedness. This is kind of the post-Ebola money that everybody's been promising for so long. It's very important that we make sure that money, where it is dedicated to research and development, actually is tied to or conditioned upon the implementation of these principles that we've been talking about. There are lots of efforts to implement specific recommendations from the HLP report at the WTO, at the WHO, and at the Human Rights Council. Those are very important. There's an important political follow-up process for the HLP report at the New York UN headquarters level that many of us are following, and we need to make sure that the good language gets into that final resolution. And there's a lot of opportunity, maybe less than some of us might have hoped at the moment in this country, but a lot of opportunity still globally at the national and regional level to actually implement in national legislation through parliamentary and legislative processes some of the specific policy recommendations coming from all of these international discussions. And in the meantime, short of like legally enforceable laws and regulations, we think there's an interesting recommendation from the HLP report to come up with a sort of code of principles. We like to think of it as an almost Helsinki-type set of principles that could be voluntarily adopted by nation states, by R&D funders, and by R&D actors that would put into practice this concept of delinkage, which I think more than anything else resolves the current trade-off that we're asked to make as a society between biomedical innovation and equitable access.
As many of you know, Senator Sanders has had a long-standing interest in this idea of decoupling and delinkage. He has introduced several bills on the topic dating back to, I think the first one was in maybe 2005, on the entire medical system, followed by a specific one for HIV/AIDS medications in 2011. He held hearing on the topic in 2012, where we were honored to have several of the panelists today here as witnesses, and it was really a great lineup and a great discussion that can still be found online. We're happy to send that testimony around if anyone wants it. So, you know, we really think that today's event is really going to help our work moving forward, and again, thank you for holding this and for having us. So, with that, I think we're going to let the panelists speak. So, first we have Rishabh Ghosh from Maastricht University.
Thanks, everybody. I wanted to talk in this concluding session on a sort of positive-looking, happier note, by talking about how delinkage has occurred in some other industries. If you go to the next slide. So we organized at Maastricht University in 2008 a workshop on prize funds across for medical prizes, but also lots of different industries. And we were looking in an area that I used to work on a lot, in open source software and open source content and open source and other types of areas. And one of the things that makes delinkage an issue at all is that it's essentially an issue of business models, of aligning where we charge for things but with where we pay for things. So this chart is not supposed to represent actual numbers, but it's a schematic of the proportional investment that is made, the total investment or the initial investment in developing the product, the initial R&D investment, versus the marginal cost. And the simplest way to describe the marginal cost is the cost of the 100th or the 50,000th item that you make. So does it cost 50,000 times, or does it cost just a little more incrementally? And if you look at the difference between different types of products, you look at building, most of the cost is going to be there for every single building you make. We see this in lots of different areas. Medicine is one, software is another, music is another. And I'm going to talk about briefly about how the business model has changed in software. So if you go to the next slide. In 1996, all the companies selling software were selling them charging unit prices. In 2016 or 2015, if you look at the top software companies or the top companies that sell, that produce a lot of software, they don't charge for their software at all. They charge for other things. They're making probably much, much more money than they used to in 1996. There's much more software that is being used by people, so there's much more production, much more innovation, much more spending on R&D, but the pricing is not a unit. That is a business model shift, obviously. It's a huge shift in the business model. And Microsoft here have still shaded as selling software, but that's not really true anymore. They don't make that much of their money selling unit price software. So the business model has shifted dramatically because of, and it's more aligned now to where it is.
So I think we're going forward to a period where there is going to be substantial and meaningful drug pricing legislation in the United States. This is money's issue that does not fundamentally change based on the election. The question is, what's the content of that legislation? And that's up for grabs, because the industry has done a pretty good job in the past of taking these moments and transforming them into wins that entrench their power, even though they're responsive to a public demand. That's going to be our big challenge. But we have an opportunity to offer something that is actually less complicated and more politically palatable, which is replacing the reliance on monopolies with various kinds, different systems, whatever, of delinkage. And those are more straightforward. There are better ways to deal with the price problems because they're direct solutions. We know that people are respond very well in the United States to proposals to deal with drug prices, and they especially respond well to proposals to redress the problem of monopoly, because they understand from their own lived experience that monopolies are the cause of the high prices. So it turns out that this tilting windmill thing from Jamie here is actually something I think is going to be very politically significant in the years ahead. It's not preordained that we're going to win, but I think it's going to become part of the national conversation very quickly, and that we have a real opportunity to do something that's very important, to deal with all the problems that we've been talking about globally, but also these very core domestic problems as well.
Thanks, Rob. Jamie, thank you again for putting together this conference today, and please share a few final thoughts, and then we have some questions, and we'll turn it over to the audience for questions.
Thank you. I think we have the room today because Senator Sanders is, and his staff has made the room available today, and we'd like to thank him for that. And also, for really the last couple years, reminding people that the voters are really hungry for people that really pay attention to their interests and take their side on things. And so that's why it's been such a pleasure to be associated with Senator Sanders and staff on these reform issues, because when other people thought it wasn't worth looking at something you couldn't do around the corner, they're willing to make, I think, an investment in an idea, and knowing that it was something that was challenging, you know, big interest and things like that. So thank you for that. And also, thank you for everyone on the panel. I'm very glad that Rob is able to be here. He's really a busy guy. And most of what I wanted to say, he has said better than I could ever say it. So thank you very much for that. And all the other panel members that have come around the world, from the Netherlands, from Barcelona, from Geneva, from Spain, you know, from Canada, everywhere else to be here today. I said earlier in the panel that the regulation of the drug monopolies is failing. I think people need to talk a little bit more openly about that, because in every other area of the economy, whether it was the regulation of the airline industry or telecommunications issues, or people have been willing to talk about changes in business models, changes in legal systems when they feel something's failing. I mean, the system of granting monopolies on drugs is a jury-rigged system. As Rob described, I mean, what's a patented invention? That takes a lot of lawyers, a lot of money to try to sort that one out. And if the more you know about it, the more you realize how arbitrary that process has become. And then you've got a whole series of sui generis regulatory monopolies that are thrown around on test data and orphan drug exclusivity, et cetera. The 20th Century Cures barely missed a whole new set of them coming out this week. The idea that you can address the abuses in the system is really, like the Bayh-Dole Act, for example. The Bayh-Dole Act, where they really privatized a lot of government-funded research through grant recipients, people would say at the time, well, you've got margin rights, you have the royalty-free right, don't worry. And of course, we're waiting here in 2016 for the first margin request to be. I remember I talked to Andy Pollack about the Xandy case, and he didn't want to write about it. He said, well, you don't even know what the case is about. He said, what are they going to grant it? And I said, well, how can I answer that question? I mean, don't you want to know the argument that we're making on behalf of saying that charging, I started going to the case. And he said, not really. I don't think they're going to grant it. I said, what you're saying is that no matter what the facts are, an abuse of a government-funded patent, right, you won't win the case. And I said, isn't that the story? I mean, forget about the extending facts. Isn't the fact that whatever the facts are irrelevant? There are no set of facts that you can even, you know, imagine as a New York Times reporter that would reach a conclusion that this is a news story. And, he never wrote about the case, but I think it's, in my mind, sometimes the lack of outrage about the dysfunctional nature of the system is is a problem. I've always told people that one way forward is to get people to actually entertain the idea that delinkage is something that could happen and pull out spreadsheets and start running the numbers. Run the numbers, what you're spending today, what you think you're going to spend 5 years from now, what you think you're going to spend 10 years ago. If you look at the aging population of the United States, it's pretty shocking. We're headed for 19% of the population being 65 and over. And as Manon said earlier, kids entering the labor force later. And nobody wants to hire you once you hit 55. We all of us older people are going to feel that one. So I think that the sustainability of the current system without a control of prices, it is, as Rob said, it is really Alice in Wonderland to think that the things can go on as they are. So if they're going to change, it's going to be one of two ways. We're either going to have a change that protects patients, or we're going to go down the road of more and more rationing and restricted access. When people talk about Medicare negotiating prices, which we're in favor of, what do you think that means under the current system? That means normally in most countries around the world, the negotiation is we will not reimburse if that drug is too expensive. That's what the negotiations are. You argue about where it is in the formulary, and that's your power. Your hostage is the patient. But the patient is a member of your family. That's the hostage you have right now in the negotiations. And that's what you need to change. You need to change it for yourselves, because you're gonna live, some of you, forever. My mother turns 100 years old this year. My wife's mother turns 95. That used to be newspaper stories. That's actually what's happening right now. Not everybody lives that long, but a lot of people do. And for those people, I mean, I've been told that every single adult male gets prostate cancer if you live long enough. I didn't really want to hear that. That's what I was told. And, you know, the thing is, we're going to need more and more care as we get older. You just can't do it. If you go down the road you do, you're just going to have to normalize the denial of there's some invention, and you can't have that invention because you didn't pay enough for your insurance premium, you're not rich enough, or something like that, or you live in the wrong country or the wrong zip code or something like that. In the UK, they call it zip code. That's how they determine who gets certain cancer drugs. Now, Rashab's slide was on how when marginal cost approaches zero in an industry, it's different. So building a car requires a lot of stuff, you know, to build a car. Some R&D, but mostly a lot of, you know, labor and steel and things like that. Making a copy of a drug is almost like making a copy of an MP3 file. It's almost the same thing. When that happens, the business models should change. All those things right now aren't ready to be done, but they're really ready to be done in a serious feasibility study sort of thing, I think.
Okay, well, I think we've probably run long enough. So thank you all again for being here and for having us. This has really been fantastic, and we look forward to continuing the conversation with you all.